wasn't on last time either. There we go. Is this on?
Yeah.
Okay. Good afternoon, everybody. Today is Monday, October 21st. It is 4 p.m. We'll go ahead and get a call to order and a roll call, please.
Mayor Shirley.
Here.
Commissioner Blanchard.
Here.
Commissioner Crawford.
Here.
Commissioner Hardy.
Here.
Commissioner Householder.
Here.
Everyone that's able, if you could please join us in a Pledge of Allegiance and moment of silence.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. We have no awards and proclamations, so we will move along to citizens' forums. This is an opportunity for anyone to come up and speak regarding an item that's not on today's agenda.
Madam Mayor and Commissioners, I'm Larry Mulliken, your fire chief, and you might be wondering what I'm doing here, but my sole role is to introduce Tammy Hunnell from the American Red Cross and let her kind of tell you why she's here. Also want to invite up Crystal Everett, one of our police officers, to represent the police department, and the reason will be clear in just a second.
Thank you. I'm here to talk to you guys about the Battle of the Badges blood drive that took place this year, the end of August. Our goal for this event was 400 units, and we collected 428 units, which is amazing. We went over goal. The community really came out and rallied behind this event. However, I don't know if a lot of people here know what the Battle of the Badges blood drive is all about. It's a friendly competition between the police department and the fire department. They get bragging rights as well as a traveling trophy, whichever agency wins the most votes from the donors that present to donate blood. Also, the agencies are responsible for helping with the recruiting aspect of the blood drive. And Chief Mulliken, Shane Pearson, was very good at working with me this year and allowing me to go to all the fire departments and talk to all the guys and kind of rally behind this event, as well as Pruitt with the police department. But with that being said, I'd like to just point out that with the 428 units that we collected, that helps up to 1,248 hospital patients here in North Central Kansas. So this blood drive is something that the Red Cross has really come to rely on, and that's these Battle of the Badges that we hold. So thank you so much to the community of Salina for allowing this event to take place and supporting it like they have. I would like to ask Jason to come up from the fire department. Jason recruited the most donors this year, which was 8. I know that doesn't seem like a lot, but they say you get one donor out of every 10 that you ask. So Jason he recruited 8 donors. So I want to present you with some gift cards from us and say thank you very much. I hope you know how much we appreciate your support and what you're doing for the hospital patients in North Central Kansas. So thank you very much. With that being said, I'd like to present the trophy to the winning agency. The police department had 170 votes, and the fire department had 239. So with that being said, Chief Mulliken gets to...
Crystal, I am so sorry you lost. I am so sorry. But we are here.
Here he comes to take it back.
Of course, Pruitt might have something to say about this. But we are here. Seems to me like there's a lot of fire department on here.
We're going to change that next year, right? Yeah. Anyways, thank you all so much.
I have to ask real quick, who won Guns and Hoses?
Hoses.
What the heck?
More and more rubbing it in.
I just got it. I'm curious now. Well,
we had a great... Come on up here, Crystal. No, you got to share this with me here. We had a great football game this year. We raised money for 2 families battling cancer. Wonderful fundraiser, great game. It's a beautiful day. We get out there and we play with injury free. Nobody got taken to the hospital or nothing. Great time. The fire department eked out a win, 8-6. But I'm telling you, they were driving. The PD was driving in the final minute, and one of our guys, Chris Householder, Not householder.
I know, the name, it just sticks with you.
Chris Stansberry.
Yeah, I tell you.
Looking at householder. Looking at the commissioner.
My brother's knee, I don't think he was playing much football, yeah.
It's a look and saying thing, you know.
With Aaron being a volunteer, please, a sheriff, you should do next year with the guns.
I don't do that anymore. Maybe I should get back on.
You should.
Yeah, I'm sure I'd be the star player.
Well, Chris Stansberry intercepted a pass in the final minute and gave us the win. We were able to hold on to the ball and win 8-6, but they were all over us. And a great tribute to the guys that you work with and a wonderful department. I love them all. The police and fire departments do a tremendous amount for the community. And I don't get to do much. I go up and run up down the sidelines and pat everybody on the back. And they may let me play for a play. They may put me in for one play. This year the game was too close. They told me I couldn't play. So that's what being the chief does for you. So anyway, thank you so much for your support, for all the things that you do for us, and for what your department does for the community, and certainly all the firefighters do.
Great. Thank you. Thanks, guys.
Is anybody else here for citizens forums? Seeing none, we'll go ahead and move to public hearings and items scheduled for a certain time.
Item 5.1, public hearing regarding the Kansas Public Water Supply Loan Fund to finance improvements for the water distribution system. Sub item 5.1A, resolution number 137045.
Ms. Tasker.
Madam Mayor and commissioners, the city made a preliminary application to the Kansas Department of Health and Environment, or KDHE, to receive funds for our water main replacement project. We received word that our project would be funded, and as a part of that, KDHE requires that we hold a public hearing to conduct a public hearing to present the information for the nature of our project, the source of revenues, and how we intend to pay for the project through the course of the time, and to review any environmental issues that may occur. And next, Melissa. And to give you a little bit of background, our water distribution system consists of about 330 miles of water mains. We have roughly 4,300 valves, 2,400 fire hydrants, and of that, 329 miles, 228 miles of that is cast iron water mains that are from 50 to 100 years old. And professional engineering consultants from Wichita completed a water distribution model for us, and based on the information from that model and information from staff and citizens' concerns, we developed a capital improvement program that was completed in 2011. We basically tagged it as a 20-year planning period, but at the end, what we really found, it was closer to a 25-year project and $100 million. And basically, we're looking at replacing $4 million of mains each year. And with this replacement, our goal is to accomplish reviving to original fire flows for the different areas, whether it's residential, commercial, or industrial. And one of the bigger issues is to replace the old cast iron pipe, which typically causes color, taste, and odor issues in the water supply, which has really been a big concern to many of our citizens throughout the city. Next. And basically, we're attacking this capital improvement program through a phased approach. And in August of 2010, the City Commission authorized $20 million, which was $4 million over the next 5 years of time frame. And to give you an idea of where we're at on that, Phase 1, Phase 2, and Phase 4 projects are complete. And the Phase 3 project, we're currently working on easements and right-of-way. Phase 5 is under construction. And the Phase 6 and 7 projects are currently the ones that we're talking about in this project, and there was a map attached to your packet that showed all of the individual areas, which we'll take a look at here in a second. And basically, what you see here, when these projects would be complete. That's roughly 22.6 miles and $10 million. And if you think in terms of 230 miles, 10% is roughly 23 miles. 10% of 100 million is $10 million. So all of these are falling fairly true in cost to what we saw when we did our study and developed our estimates. Roughly at the cost we're seeing today, it's roughly $450,000 for a mile of water main, or $85 a linear foot. And so far, all of our projects have fell in line with that very close. Next, Melissa. This is the sketch of all of the areas that we're working in for Phase 6 and Phase 7. And as you can notice, we're just about in every quadrant of the city trying to make some improvements. And the total here would be, between Phase 6 and Phase 7, would be about 9 miles of line. So, and I can say that from being out in the community that many citizens have came to me after these projects have been completed and are really pleased with the quality of water. So it's one of those projects where you kind of feel good at the end because people really are noticing it and see a big difference. Next, Melissa. When we look at what the requirements are for the loan, we have to look at all of the environmental conditions, and typically those are pretty simple on a water main replacement project. We look at dust, noise, and erosion control. And from the standpoint of environmental clearance, we've sent our plans for our project to 12 different state agencies. We've heard back from 7 agencies, and they have no concerns. Next. So basically what we're looking at for our loan amount is $4 million for the water main replacements. The engineering we'll be doing in-house with in-house staff. We've included roughly a 6% contingency of $239,375. And then there's a loan origination fee through KDHE of $10,625. So our proposed loan amount will be $4,250,000. Next. And to take a look at the financing, typically through the State Revolving Loan Fund, their interest rate is roughly 60% of the market rate. The loan that we received a little over a year ago was at 2.12%. In July, when we received the letter, it was 2.37%. When we checked for October's loan rate, it's 2.84%. So we're seeing that interest rate creep up, but in general it's to be 60% of the market rate. So we took a look at conventional financing, and basically the $4,250,000 at an interest rate of 4% equates to $1,830,000 in for the loan over 20 years in interest. Option two, same issue, only an interest rate of 2.84, we're roughly $1,220,000 over the 20 years in interest payments. So what we see with option two using the State Revolving Loan Fund is roughly $30,500 per year, or $610,000 over the life of the loan, assuming the 4%, and maybe that actually would be a little more. And what I can say is the cost for these improvements have been included in our water rate study at the conventional rate of 4%. So these all have been factored in, and basically that $610,000 buys us another 6,100 feet of water line over the course of the loan. So over a mile of water main, we can replace with that savings, just to give you an idea of overall dollars. At this point, I would be glad to answer any questions you have, and then I can move to...
Nothing really on this. I'm just curious. You know, I always see these contingencies, and I guess I've never bothered to ask. How often do we use those? And if we don't use those, what do they become part of? Are they instantly paid back to the note to avoid paying interest on $239,000, or do we hold them over for a year? Or how?
At the end of the process, the loan will be determined what the actual dollar figure was, and if that's not included, then we just don't borrow that dollar amount.
Perfect. Okay.
The loan origination fee, is that a fixed amount or is that a percent
of
the loan?
It's a percentage. I believe on the last one that was $9.3 million, it was roughly $30,000. So it's a percentage that they calculate.
Okay. And that goes to the agency that writes the bond then? Or?
Yes.
Okay.
Ms. Tasker, phases 6 and 7 represent what part of the overall, how many more phases are going to be?
How many more phases? Well, if we do, we're authorized for the $20 million. And so if we look at $4 million a year, we're trying to do those in $2 million phases. We have about 5 phases left before we come back and ask for additional dollars for the next round.
I seem to recall your map at the water department with the different colored squiggly lines on it and representing the phases. So
if we look at this, we've started making the phases a little larger. Originally, we looked at about $1 million phases. Now we're trying to get a little closer to $2 million.
Right.
And if we have $100 million of projects over the next 25 years and we do $2 million phases, I guess we could have 50 phases or 40 phases left, depending upon where and when we stop doing main replacements. But
you have to go back and learn Roman numerals all over again.
Yeah, we're going to change from that. Somehow that's going to be hard after we get to 10 for me.
Yeah.
Did that answer your question?
Yes, ma'am.
Commissioner Blanchard? Mm-hmm. It's a long project, and we're just getting a good start.
Well, it's probably a lot of its continual maintenance as well.
It really is.
Yeah, it's never going to end.
So. And then once we get the next 25 years, then we'll have a new round of pipe that's 50 to 100 years old.
Okay.
We'll get it all that's done just in time to start all over again.
Thanks, Kay.
This past week, I was driving down Crawford, and right around Sunset Plaza, I noticed there was some sort of a break, and it had to be repaired. Would that have been an older part of the system, or since the 60s?
I would have to look, because in some cases we have paralleling lines. We actually have it on our GIS system that we can pull up the line and look at the age.
Is most of the break that you experience, would that be the older system, or is it the newer system, or is it half and half, or?
It's very rarely our new ductile iron pipe, because obviously we don't have a lot of that newer pipe, but typically it's the old cast iron pipe that we do have issues with, and the good share of our city is in that 50 to 100 year age.
When you do have a break, you go back and put the newer line in to...
When we fix a main break like that, it could be anything from a small section of pipe to just a clamp to cover a hole or a crack in the pipe. So we're not really replacing pipe of any distance when we do a main break. We're just repairing it and getting everyone back in service. But we do track all of those main breaks on a map and then allocate those into our plan and look at the age of the pipe and condition to make those type of decisions for the capital improvement program.
That was I was impressed by the speed that you work at when something happens.
Our goal is to have a water main break be there and have it repaired in 4 hours or less, and a good share of the time we accomplish that unless there's something really unique about it.
Any other questions for staff?
Do you need me to cover the recommendation, or do you?
You can go ahead and cover the recommendation, then I'll get public
then
comment.
We'll get public comment, all right. Staff has identified two options for the City Commission. The first would be to adopt resolution number 13-7045, authorizing the completion of an application to the Kansas Department of Health and Environment regarding a loan from the Kansas Public Water Supply Fund. The second would be to not adopt the resolution number 13-7045 and give further direction to the staff. Staff recommends option one.
Thank you.
Is there any public comment on this matter?
Seeing no public comment, I can go ahead and close the public hearing and bring it back to the commission.
Madam Mayor, I move that we adopt resolution number 13-7045 with authorizing the completion of an application of the Kansas Department of Health and Environment regarding a loan from the Kansas Public Water Supply Loan Fund.
Second.
I have a motion in 2 seconds. All those in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? Motion carries 5-0. Move on to consent agenda.
Item 6.1, approve the minutes of October 7, 2013. Item 6.2, resolution number 137050, appointing members to the Accessibility Advisory Board, Building Advisory Board, and the Parks and Recreation Advisory Board. Item 6.3, rescind first reading approval of ordinance numbers 09-10492 and 09-10493, annexing and rezoning the proposed Wheatland Hills addition. Item 6.4, rescind first reading approval of ordinance number 09-10506, rezoning the proposed Welsh addition. Item 6.5, acknowledge completion of the Grand Avenue Bridge structural component and authorize payment to Saline County for one half of the share of the project cost in the amount of $48,104.94.
Is there anything a commissioner would like to change or have amended on the consent agenda?
Yeah, Madam Mayor, I ask that items 6.3 and 6.4 be placed on the regular agenda.
Second.
Are you talking about today's regular agenda or a future?
Yes, ma'am. Now this. Just
have a motion.
I don't believe we need a motion and a second on that, do we?
Generally, by virtue of any commissioner's request, those items do just automatically come off, and then it's a matter of considering the consent agenda after those items have been removed. So I think if I'm following correctly, I think the second possibly preceded the motion to approve the consent agenda, so I think you're still probably in need of a motion to approve the consent agenda.
Okay. Okay, go ahead and approve the consent agenda with the removal of items 6.3 and 6.4.
Or I should make a motion to approve the consent agenda, less items 6.3 and 6.4.
I'll second that.
I have a motion and a second. All those in favor?
Aye. Aye.
All those opposed? Motion passes. 5-0. Now with the 6.3 and 6.4, if it's going on the regular agenda, do we move that up on... Will that be my next item, or will that be later on?
In the normal course, that would be your next item.
Okay. All right.
I prefer to have it placed elsewhere.
Okay, consent agenda. So we will move on to item 6.3. All right. Mr. Andrew.
Make sure I get them in the right order. Item 6.3 is rescinding approval of two ordinances that were approved by the City Commission in 2009, and they related to a 36.15-acre tract located at the northeast corner of East Crawford Street and Holmes Road. And John has them displayed on the screen there. The area shaded in gray there was a request from Landmark Development Company, and they were wanting to take property that was zoned Saline County Agricultural and rezone it to a planned development district with single-family and two-family development, with the R2.5 being in the far southeast corner. And the Planning Commission recommended approval of that. It went to the City Commission in June of 2009, and it was approved on first reading subject to platting. And it was right about that time that there was a change in the local residential market, and both this developer and a nearby developer wanted to preserve the design work and investment they'd already had by keeping their plat alive for an extended period of time. That extension was granted by the Planning Commission, but that time extension has now expired. There's never been a final plat filed for this property, and because of that, the appropriate action would be to rescind by motion the first reading approval of those two ordinances. The effect of that would be that basically it would go back to the status quo it was in 2009. It would go back to being Saline County agricultural land and outside the city limits, And so by making a motion to rescind those, it basically sends it back to the status quo and closes this out. And if the developer wishes to proceed in the future, they would need to file all new applications.
Thank you. The couple of the things that I had a question on this was I understand that by the plat, the preliminary plat dying where it is and not moving to a final plat, that that the zoning will revert to agriculture, but the annexation is still in effect. I mean, we still
The two ordinances that you see listed there, one annexed the property into the city limits and the other one assigned a zoning classification. Those were only approved on first reading, never adopted, and so by rescinding them, it keeps the property in its status of unincorporated Saline County.
Okay. Was the purposes of this dying? You had mentioned in 2009 the real estate market turning down, yet we recently had an annexation request for 80, probably about the equal number of lots. Is there is the primary purpose that, or were there other? I know number three here with the questions about adequate water supply. Was the water supply deemed to be sufficient there, or was it just the market?
There was going to need to be some looping. The water line does not go out that far. It currently ends at the First Christian Church, and it currently goes along Brookwood but doesn't go all the way, so there would have been a need for a loop to come there for one thing, and then there would need to have been water extended down Crawford and internally within the subdivision. And at the time, staff was somewhat skeptical that if you did multifamily in this corner, that would have the highest fire flow requirements and the highest need for water supply. And so that was the reason for that, was for to put the burden on the applicant's design engineer to show that he could get the water supply to that area.
And is that northeast portion there, the multifamily, is that what would be the 115 apartments, or?
Yes.
Okay.
This piece right here. So
this is Holmes,
and this is Crawford, and this is the southeast corner. This up here was going to be a detention area, so the apartments would have been in this area.
And how many, I read this over the weekend, but how many single-family lots was that? Did that represent?
61 lots.
61, okay, thanks. Thank you, Mr. Andrew.
And I think the thing to remember about some of these is that developers don't always share, and they don't always have subdivisions where the lots are open to just any builder to build in. Sometimes they're exclusive, and so 61 lots to one developer may not feel like for other builders that it's opening up lots for them. But this is the same developer who did the Woodland Hills addition, which is Pine Ridge, Estates Drive, that area in there. So we think to get this off the books and close it out, these ordinances should be rescinded by motion so they revert back to their earlier state.
I just have a, it should be an easy answer. 2009, and then it says 24 months after. Why is this coming in 2013?
Well, the expiration was actually July of 2013 from their 24. They had a 12-month period to get it done, and they didn't get it done within the 12 months, so they got an additional 24-month extension to keep their plat alive, and it expired in July, and it just took from July till now to get them informed and get okay. this back in front of you.
I told you it'd be an easy answer. Thanks. Is there any other questions for staff? Okay. Do I have any public comment?
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Andrew. No public comment on this matter. I'll bring it back to the commission.
Well, we need a, this is for council, will we need to make two separate motions on this for each separate ordinance?
That would certainly be in order, if okay. that would be your preference, Commissioner.
All right. And so I would ask, is 09-10492, would that be the annexation portion?
To double check with Mr. Andrew to be sure.
Yeah, it's
it is. I've got that. Thank you. Madam Mayor, I move that we approve ordinance number 09-10492, rescinding first reading approval of ordinance number 09-10492, annexing the proposed Wheatland Hills addition subdivision.
Second.
I have a motion and a second. All those in favor?
Aye. Aye.
All those opposed? That motion carries 5-0.
Madam Mayor, I move to approve ordinance number 09-10493, rescinding the first reading approval of ordinance 09-10493, rezoning the proposed Wheatland Hills addition subdivision.
Second.
And I have a motion and a second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All those opposed?
Mayor Shirley, just for clarification, that's approval of the item and not the ordinance.
Oh.
To approve item 6.3, rescinding the ordinances.
You said the ordinance number, didn't you?
Yeah, I repeated that. I repeated the ordinance, but I did in the motion state that
to rescind them.
Yeah, perhaps just clarification that the motion was just a motion action to rescind the ordinance number that you
correct.
Had recited. I think that would get it.
He doubly rescinded it.
So do we need to we're good? Okay. That motion carried 5-0. Moving on to item 6.4. Mr. Andrew again.
This is a neighboring property. The primary difference between this property and the property you just discussed is that this property was annexed into the city as an A1 zone parcel along with the Pheasant Ridge Addition number 2 and a piece of property north of the First Christian Church. And so the reason you see one ordinance number on here is that this would not be rescinding the annexation, the city limit line. This property owned by Todd Welsh has been annexed. This property owned by First Christian Church has been annexed. This property was annexed. And the primary purpose of that was so that this property here, if it was in fact annexed, would be contiguous to the city limits and not a leap out there. And also this property to develop needs the cooperation of these properties to get water extended, and these properties need the cooperation of this property to get sewer lines over to the interceptor sewer line. So that's why these were somewhat considered in the same time frame. But this action relates to this shaded area here. It's close to 8 acres. It was proposed as an 18-lot subdivision with one commercial lot at the corner. It was approved on first reading in July 2009. There was 1 year to complete the platting. There was a 2-year extension of the life of the plat that has expired as of July of this year, and the appropriate action would be to rescind approval of that ordinance 09-10506, and that would have this revert back to A1 agricultural zoning and start over on any future plans for the property.
Any questions for Mr. Andrew?
No, I assume that the reasons are pretty much the same as the other one.
Yes, they were given 12 months to do a final plat. They didn't complete it because they didn't want to lose the investment and work that they'd already done in the design. They tried to keep the plat alive for an extended period, but still have never final platted the property. So the appropriate thing would be to send it back to agricultural status.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Any public comment on this matter?
Madam Mayor, Commissioners, Todd Wells, 221 South Morse Drive. Mr. Blanchard, Commissioner Blanchard, I was just going to shed a little bit of light on this for a couple of reasons, because I'm always the one coming in front of you saying we need more lots, yet my name's on one where we're abandoning lots saying we can't do it. So to shed a little bit of light on this particular project, the owners of the secondary property wanted to come in, it made sense for us to do that. After looking at how much the water loop would be, the sanitary sewer, abandoning pump stations, it was a little over $2 million. And really, when we went and tried to create a benefit district, everybody wanted ag deferrals. So Overland Adventures wasn't ready yet. Darwin was only going to put in like 10 or 12 lots. I was still waiting for another piece that was there. And so financially for the city, it just didn't make sense for us to even come forward and ask for all of that, knowing that all these ag deferrals were going to be put in place. So at that point, Darwin with Landmark Development just said, look, I think I'm going to abandon this. I abandoned that property. I didn't abandon it, but the plan for it, and then move forward to the workforce housing project over on the 8 acres that were there. So I want to give you a little bit of an idea. If you don't know the topography of that, the shaded area that's there now, from there, everything goes to the east, which means the sewer line then would hook up with the main interceptor that's out there. No longer would we need to be pumping back and forth. So at some point, we had to figure out how to pump over that hill or to run a line, and we ran it. It's almost 19 or 20 feet deep in some areas to get sewer out of the city down to the main interceptor. So it just didn't work at this time. Later on, I always tell my son that I'm going to bring him with me, because 10 or 20 years, we may be able to develop that and make it feasible when everybody's ready to do something in that area. So I hope that answers some questions.
Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you.
Is there any other public comment on this matter? Seeing none, I'll bring it back to the commission.
Madam Mayor, I move to rescind the first reading approval of ordinance number 0910506, rezoning the proposed Welsh Addition subdivision.
Second.
I have a motion and a second. All those in favor?
Aye. Aye.
All opposed? That motion carries 5-0. On to item 6.5.
Oh, I believe that was passed. No.
That was part of the consent agenda. Sorry. See, threw me off. We have nothing in administration today. We'll move on to development business.
Item 8.1, application number M13-6, requesting an amendment to the future land use map of the comprehensive plan to change the future land use designation of the east side of South Cherry Street, south of State Street, from future urban residential to future employment.
Mr. Andrew.
Madam Mayor, Commissioners, items 8.1 and 8.2 are companion items, and they were both sent back by the Commission to the Planning Commission for reconsideration. And the first item, 8.1, deals with a request filed by two landowners on the east side of South Cherry Street, south of State Street. And the area in question, John has on the screen there, and the area that he has up there is how the property was originally laid out and platted. But as part of our comprehensive plan, we have a future land use map that serves as a guide to future land uses within the city and the adjoining urban service area. And the area west of Broadway and south of State Street is designated as future urban residential on the city's current future land use map. So, John, maybe you could please go to the PDF that is the original future land use map. So, perhaps not on this one, on the version, I think, in your packet, I have circled the area that we're focused on. but it's this area right here with this black line being Broadway and this being State Street. And we'll see if John can enlarge that area for us. But the area that's west of Broadway and south of State Street is shown as urban residential. It's right here. The area to the north is shown as employment. And the applicant in this case, Mr. Wooster and Mr. Dethridge, are requesting that the future land use designation be changed to employment to support a request for I-2 zoning. And so, again, they're talking about taking a portion of this urban residential and converting it to employment area. We gave you quite a bit of background information about the Broadway corridor and the concepts for future redevelopment of the Broadway corridor, but that plan states that the existing commercial and industrial development along Broadway and south of State Street should be redeveloped with higher intensity urban residential uses. It goes on to discuss that it will be a challenge just because of some of the existing conditions and the challenges associated with infill. But the application, as you can see, the north side of State Street is shown as employment area, the south side, future residential. That urban residential is not consistent with and would not support an extension of I-2 zoning. So this was a necessary first step. Your role was and continues to be to determine whether you see Cherry Street south of State Street as, first of all, part of the Broadway redevelopment corridor. And if so, then you need to consider whether making land use decisions in this area should be based on existing development patterns or the future vision set for this area. And again, this is the area shown as industrial, this is shown as urban residential, and then that is a concept of what consists of the Broadway corridor, but by description it actually extends all the way out to the west city limits, which is a flood control levee. Planning Commission looked at this. They did not consider this area here to be, in their minds, part or did not recognize it as part of the Broadway corridor, and because of that, they first of all recommended that this employment area to the north be extended south for that area. You considered that recommendation in September, on September 9th. You disagreed with that recommendation, and you sent the application back to the Planning Commission for reconsideration, asking them to evaluate the impact that such a change would have on this whole area, and particularly the 55-acre Gardner tract that is west of Cherry Street. Planning Commission reconsidered this at their September 17th meeting, and at the conclusion of that hearing, they chose to modify their original recommendation, and they approved a motion to recommend that the comprehensive plan map amendment be denied, and they recommended that it be denied because they felt this area just focusing here was too small. They reiterated their belief that the future land use map is incorrect in its long-term vision for this area, and they didn't see urban residential designation as realistic, but rather than focusing just on this area here, they thought that there should be a steady or revisiting of the entire area and whether it should be future residential or not. So this comes back to you with a modified recommendation, and that recommendation is to deny the plan amendment request. And you've got two options, one of which would be to approve the request and change this area from urban residential to employment, or you could deny the requested amendment based on the findings you made at the September 9th meeting. And either of those actions would require three affirmative votes and would be final at this stage. So we are at the final decision point. There are no needs or requirements to refer anything back to the Planning Commission. This is final decision. So with that, I'd be open to any questions. I know the applicant and their representatives are here as well if you have questions of them.
Any questions for staff?
I have one brief question, and it's kind of it's in regard to looking at the overall. And you had mentioned that they requested that a study be done to determine whether we need to not just look at changing that whole future urban resident from future urban residential to future employment. What is the process of that? Would a study? What would that study look like?
I think the study might perhaps have some additional information about the history and ownership and any previous development proposals for the area. It might entail some information about the trends and number of multifamily housing units constructed over a certain period of time, reports about the more specific information about existing utilities, and also what the prospects are in terms of cost estimates and all for those utilities, and then if there is a difference or distinction between the utility needs of residential versus future industrial type uses.
Were any of those items considered when they made this future urban residential? Did they, in the eyes of the planners that laid this out, did they see this more of a continuation of the Broadway corridor?
They viewed it as a continuation of the Broadway corridor, and the overarching theme, and I won't speak for them exactly, but the overarching theme is that City of Salina, like many communities, is overzoned for commercial. And so their belief was that as you expand and you have additional commercial zoning in the southern part of the community, you're leaving behind commercial areas that used to be more prime retail areas that no longer are, and that it was more desirable to try to convert those to alternate uses than to try to perpetuate their life as retail in the future. So their recommendation was to focus on this corridor and to try to focus on urban residential and mixed use concepts and to move away from the retail. And in doing so, they started here, and basically, because this was a somewhat of a blank slate, they continued that as well.
And do you know, prior to the adoption of this comprehensive plan, prior to the Planning Commission voting to approve it, were there any concerns at that time initiated about whether or not this area in particular or other areas were appropriately designated?
And that will come up as we discuss item 8.3, but there were areas where the planning staff went through and took the work of the consultant, and we identified something between 50 and 60 land use conflicts, and we made modifications or recommended modifications for those, and there were 10 that were identified primarily that were shown as commercial today and proposed as urban residential. And both the Planning Commission and City Commission at the time of adoption were aware of that, and it was pointed out, everyone knew that this was shown as urban residential at the time.
Okay. Thank you.
Any other questions for staff?
As I said, we do have representatives of the applicant here if you have questions of them.
Just a quick thought, commissioners. You can see how anyone could look at that and say, well, I don't know if that should be treated in the same way Broadway. On the same hand, we know that we don't have utilities extended further west, so what are you going to do out there? You have limited kind of bulky uses in it if it's zoned industrially. And I'm not talking about, I'm talking more broader than just the site in question. Because the site in question was an annexed, legally grandfathered use on that site. But when you look at that whole area, you know, if you back up in time before we annex property, what is it typically? It's usually agricultural property. We bring it in as agricultural until it's ready to be developed, which many times is when it's brought in. So when you think about that, if that property's not ready for development today because of utilities, who's to say that 30, 40, 50 years from now it might not be? You might get some kind of a prospect and have a reason to do something out there. You might not. It's hard to tell. But if you look at that R5, you might say, well, maybe it shouldn't be R5. You could also look at a rezoning to agricultural as well, just as a holding zone for agricultural, because, quite honestly, you're not going to get any residential without any utilities. I don't know that there'd be a problem with taking property like that back to an agricultural state and a holding state either. The key is I think, is if we get into a situation where we say, well, it's not ready to develop a certain way now, we don't have utilities, I think from a broader perspective, we need to be very careful zoning something into industrial, into which you can have some of those, just a handful of those bulky uses that could occur out there, and in essence, you're not going to get that back later. And again, I'm speaking more to the broader question, more so than this specific question, but I do agree that if you look at that area, I agree with the Planning Commission, and also based on the conversation we had earlier, you really shouldn't take a little piece and change it from residential to industrial. You should really look at that whole area and decide what you want to do. And it may be very much that you think that you're looking at the area to the west versus the area to the east. Either way, having it in a position to hold is not necessarily a bad thing. That use can, the industrial uses can still go on legally, even though they're non-conforming for some time. They just can't be expanded. And if there's a significant time lapse of when the use is being used in that way, totally dormant type situation, then it would go back. I believe that's a year. Usually that doesn't happen, so I don't think that's going to happen. But just think the focus on a big area is a really important focus to take.
Question for Mr. Gage. Yeah. Related to that, is there a certain designation that might make that area more attractive to developers rather than the one it has now?
Well, if I drive up and down that street and I put my hat on and decide, and I have all the money in the world and I could develop on that property, the first thing I'd want is utilities. And without utilities, you're really not going to see much of anything. There might be a handful of, and Mr. Andrew could tell you that there may be a handful of some industrial uses you might be able to put on there without having to extend water and sewer. I don't know. You couldn't have an office, I don't believe. So that's the first thing. But if I had utilities, I'm going to look around. I'm going to ask myself, what would I want to be here? Do I like what I see to the north? Do I like what I see to the east? Pretty good chance, unless you're going to do the same thing, you know, that's going on to the north or to the east, you'd say no. For example, if I'm going to invest in if I have a really nice high-density residential development, would I put it there? I might. I might not. You don't like what you're going to see to the north and to the east, that's for sure. The other side of that is so do you give up and allow that to become what you see to the north and to the east? If that's a default position, we have a lot of places in the community we could apply that position. It doesn't help necessarily with the aesthetics of our community, and it's probably, you'd have to probably look at how much of that type of use do we have and how much do we need, because we know we're not going to make it pretty. Mm-hmm. I think that's a given. So I'd evaluate those things. I think if you took down the row of trees and you could put a couple box culverts, you could extend the Broadway use if there's demand in the area. You could go further back mm-hmm. if that mm-hmm. property wasn't mm-hmm. being used. I think we look at trees and we just automatically, and we know there's a little drainage ditch there, and we say, oh, we can't go further back. Sure you can. You see it all over the place in larger metropolitan areas. You'll have, actually some of those are man-made drainage ditches, and there's a box culvert here and one down the road and extend in, and you can do all kinds of things back there. You could see mixed use commercial on Broadway and maybe some higher density residential behind. That's very common type of use in areas. Will it happen? Well, you have to have demand along Broadway to do that. Will that happen? I don't know. That's why it's in the area of change, is we don't have demand. And really if we rename the area of change, it would be the area that we want to see have demand for development, residentially or commercially. We don't have that today. So by calling it the area of change means we want to focus on it, not let it get worse, try to make it better, recognizing that it may not, and you may have to apply tools to it, whether it be land use incentives, other tools, and be patient and wait over a long period of time. I think the key is you don't want it to get worse, because if it gets worse, your probabilities are going to also go down. That's sort of the way I look at it. But you do have to look over a pretty long time frame, because the uses to the north and to the east currently are not something that most folks want to look at if they invest in their property.
I like your idea of the the culverts and stuff. And as I look at this aerial map, I can't completely accurately see, but is that drainage ditch, is it just sort of developed from what I see on my map somewhere around Walnut Street and then just kind of heads up north and I think drains into that little kind of where that railroad area is and all that?
That's Dry Creek, isn't it?
Yeah, it is Dry Creek. I believe, yes.
It's pretty much just drainage. You know, I start thinking of how difficult, as they redevelop that area, is it to simply bury the drainage and not even be using a ditch. All of a sudden, that disappears. That ground becomes level. Obviously, you can't build over it. But as you connect, like you said, culverts with Walnut, there's a building in front of Marietta, but, you know, even one or two of those, all of a sudden that, and you, like you said, you rid those trees and you rid that, that all becomes one huge area instead of thinking of that small little Dry Creek as a buffer of those trees. That aggregates enough property to really, really do something there. Is it going to happen tomorrow? Probably not. But I think it does show the importance of not locking ourselves in. And, you know, we just had a meeting, our previous meeting in our study session, talking about the river project and things like that. And whether that ever becomes a reality, that's, that's for speculation too. But State Street still becomes one of our main entryways to downtown in the areas that we're really trying to redevelop. And I agree with you, the north and the east probably don't look the best. But as land values go up and things change in communities, maybe they become more valuable than their current uses. The owners decide, hey, we're going to sell, and, you know, they can develop. Again, it's all speculation, but I also don't think we want to necessarily go changing our comprehensive plan again for, you know, one property, which I think we'd kind of have a little bit of a habit of doing sometimes. Whether changing it to the ag designation is a better move, I mean, I don't know. I mean, I'm kind of with Commissioner Hardy on that. You know, is there something that maybe does make it a little more attractive, or, you know, I suppose that's worth considering. But
yeah, I think that the only reason you might do that is because some would say, well, it's zoned residentially and it can't be used that way, therefore it justifies zoning it industrially. I would say no, it doesn't. But if that's a holding zone that leads someone to think it should go to a higher density, then perhaps it should go back to the way it might have come in the first place.
That being said, I don't know if I mentioned this last meeting, I do have a little bit of heartache, I guess, for Mr. Wooster's business that's there. I don't know that he's used it in the last few years, and I think he's maybe sort of abandoned it. I assume that falls back into its initial, which is what, residential, or it's no longer allowed as a business?
Yeah, I believe there's one, and Dean, we may need to have you go to the map and point this out. There's one existing, I think, residential strip that was rezoned many, many years ago.
This blue box represents the holdings of Mr. Wooster, and his Wooster VW repair was right here in this building, and he has informed us that while the VW, he still has vehicles in there, he still tinkers and does work there, so it has not been abandoned.
Okay.
But we did point out that basically uses such as this, including the salvage yard down here, this here, if there is 12 continuous months of non-use for a business period, then the grandfathering status expires, and then the only use it could be put to is to some residential use or use that the RS zoning allows.
And have we determined that he hasn't been there for 12 months, or is he
is still there. He has confirmed that he has not abandoned the property.
Okay.
He's still using it. It's not a Volkswagen repair business, but he is still using it for repair. He still owns it. He still tinkers with cars there and has them stored there, but he doesn't have his full-scale VW repair
operation. Okay. I mean, that was one that sort of, you know,
This is the applicant's property. This formerly had a house on it. The house was demolished in the 1970s, and it's been vacant since that time.
Mm-hmm. Dean, with regards to that particular use, just to make sure we differentiate between a personal hobby and a business, do you know, does he take in income for the work that he does in that facility?
Not that I'm aware, but I do know that the county appraiser classifies it as a commercial property for property tax purposes.
So that's the reference we know. We don't know really the activity.
That's the only reference I have, is that that's the way the county appraiser has it classified.
Because from the zoning perspective, as some of you know, it's about the activity that happens. It's really not relevant with regards to the county appraiser's perspective.
Be there. Okay, yeah, I mean, like I said, my only concern was it seems very commercial in nature. You know, not necessarily the best-looking structure or anything, but it does seem very commercial in nature. I think we'd have a difficult time selling it as residential at this stage, but I guess it's sort of an afterthought of this whole project. I definitely wouldn't want to see more industrial going in there. I agree with that, but until we come up with a better use, I sure hate to see this guy paralyzed by, you know, this turn it back into residential. So
any other questions for staff? Any public comment on this matter?
I'm Ed Etheridge, DD Rowland. I'm the one that's trying to get this into just a pad to where we can park our equipment. You know, I know we cannot put a building in because there's no water, no sewage. If we tried to resell the property as a residential area, there's no way we could do that because we can't build a home. Or otherwise, we would be up here trying to get a permit for building a home, but we can't do that. So I'm just trying to get it to where we can use it, to where it'll be justified, because I know I've talked to the neighboring parties. I've talked to the man that takes care of BRC Bearing, Dale, and he has no problem with that being rezoned. I've talked to Perry's Auto. They're the ones that have the I-2 in between Wooster and us, which is zoned I-2, and they are glad that we have went in there and cleaned that up, because the property was really bad before we took it over. And then I've also contacted Mr. Roenick. I don't know if he's here this evening or not, but he is in favor of doing this also. And then I've contacted Mr. Gardner, the man that owns the field right next to us on the other side of Cherry. And at the present time, I visited with him quite a bit on that, and at the present time, he is going to keep farming that till he dies. And he is not really interested in either housing or changing it to I-2. He said that he is going to farm it till he dies. And that's kind of where he's at on that property, too. And I've got a letter that I had made up, and he has signed it, stating that what he plans to do with it. And the only time that he is going to change that is when he dies, if somebody buys it or his son decides to do something with that. And that'll probably be 50, 60 years from now, probably. So, you know, for the present time, you know, we're trying to develop something there and clean it up and keep it clean. We're not the type that's going to go in there and have it a trashy-looking place. We've got other properties, and we keep them maintained, too. Because if you have something that looks terrible, then you have more complaints than what a person really needs. And I don't, you know, I live here in Salina, and I want to keep it looking clean. I don't want, you know, I don't want to be looking like some of the areas that we do have, unfortunately. So, other than that, do you have any questions?
No, I'd just like to say I appreciate the position that you're in, having the property, wanting to make use of it, and having zoning issues that aren't compatible with the way you want to use that property. How long have you owned that property?
Well, before we purchased it, we asked the realtor what it was zoned, and he had contacted the city, and they said it was I-2. And then when we went in to get some permits and stuff, we was going to put a fence in, they said, you can't do anything. That's residential.
Well, generally, I believe that just for records record searches on through the county. Generally, the zoning is listed on
there. But it didn't have it on there that I'm aware of. And the realtor that sold the property should have known, should have had that looked up way before we even purchased it. You see what I'm saying?
Yeah, I would agree with you on that. And so I think I understand where you were, where you are on that. I think, you know, we've got the two issues of the rezoning and the land use.
Right.
As it works out, the land use indicates what you can do zoning-wise.
Right.
And so that's, as you very well know,
yeah,
that's where we are with the issue.
Mm-hmm.
And so we're looking at sort of big picture. And like I said, I realize that you have a that parcel that you're wanting to do, and I think there's certain special circumstances wrapped around that and your acquisition of that and so on that are unfortunate. So,
yeah.
But I just want you to know that at least from my standpoint, where I try to make the decision is based on what our plan is, whether that makes sense, how
mm-hmm.
the zoning fits into that. So, I can tell you that I do feel for you. That doesn't mean a lot to you, I'm sure, but I do,
yeah,
personally. So,
but yeah, for you know, and I've been in Salina for quite a few years, and nothing has really been done in that area. You know, really no improvements for anything in that area except for the newer buildings that are industrial in that area. And then if you go farther south, then you run right into industrial again. So you have industrial to the north, industrial to the south, and all the commercial along Broadway. And more than likely, I really doubt if you're going to see any of them buildings be removed and high-rises put in for residential. So, and trying to fill in that Dry Creek area, you'd have to go through the state and quite a few other processes to get that built up to where you could even develop anything in that low-lying area. So, you know, a person has a lot to do if they're trying to get that developed and raised up to add some footage. So, that's where we're at on that. So, and I don't know if anybody else is in here that would want to say anything.
Just as still a licensed realtor myself, I mean, obviously we don't like hearing when a realtor says something and something goes wrong. Did you seek an attorney about this real estate agent who told you that this was I-2?
Not yet, I haven't.
Yeah, that my advice to you, if you felt like that, you know, that this guy had steered you in the wrong direction, I mean, probably a big risk for the real estate agent to go up there and tell you.
What do you think, Wally? What do you think on that? What do you think on that part? Yeah. Well, I know. But Wally was, you know, with us on that deal, too.
Well, I mean, if you're real estate, if you're claiming your real estate agent told you it was I-2 and it wasn't, you bought it based on your real estate agent's recommendation, I sure as heck would get an attorney.
Well, yeah.
I don't know how much the land property was. Maybe nobody will take your case. Maybe you got to pay for it. But I'd rather pay some attorney fees and get my $10,000, $15,000, yeah, $27,000, whatever it cost
you. Well, we've done some cleanup since then, too.
Yeah.
A lot of cleanup. So.
Just a thought.
Yeah.
He points out.
Yeah. Disclosure here.
What are you going to do, John, with that little piece of ground? You're going to have somebody go build a house in there? Todd Welsh wouldn't go in there and do something like that. You couldn't get a house builder to go in there and build a house. There's no way in the world that ever happened. And Ed just read you a letter that the guy who owns the 55 acres is going to leave it a wheat field. I mean, got a little sliver of land, he needs to use it, and we were told it was zoned certain things by another realtor, and so we'd like to use it as we were told it could be used. That's a real simple thing to do. You got a Roenick on the south side, you got Wooster on the north, you got an I-2, and again, you're not going to build a house on this property, period, end of sentence. Would you agree with that?
I wouldn't necessarily agree with that.
You wouldn't?
No, I wouldn't. I think that the Mr. Gage clearly, I thought, eloquently laid out the basically what comprehensive plans are, and that is that, you know, we're looking at existing patterns versus future vision. A comprehensive plan looks at a future vision. It looks at, do you want to encourage more of an undesired activity, which we can make that all employment night too. All that is doing is encouraging a less desirable outcome than we want, or we can act in a way that is consistent with our comprehensive plan. We can follow our plan, continue to implement that, which leaves the opportunities available for the future vision to be realized. If we just do I-2, it's stop it, game over, we know exactly what we're going to get. Now, one thing that I think a lot of people probably don't understand is when they hear a land use called future urban residential, they think of high-rises, and they think of multi-story apartment buildings. Well, that's not it. If you refer to the comprehensive plan, what that zone urban residential refers to is mixed-use development. And so there's a lot that we need to do to educate ourselves about what the different terms are in that plan and what the different areas that we've determined are to have those uses designated for. And I think once we have that, then some of the ideas of, you know, we look at what are the existing patterns. If we went all around town and said, we're going to take whatever the existing patterns of it, and our future is going to be doing more of that right there, then we don't have any future vision. It's more of a, let's just do things as they happen. And we're trying to get ahead of that. That's sort of what the nature and the art of planning is trying to take a vision, put it on paper, implement it, and then hopefully 20 years down the road we're in a position where we had imagined we might be and happy about it, instead of trying to figure out how it is we got here. So, I don't necessarily think that area is doomed to be in the condition it is currently, just because it's that way now. So,
well, with all due respect, we're going to get Mr. Roenick say, okay, you got to take your salvage yard out of there. Then we're going to go to Worcester and say, you got to get rid of your place. And the young man who owns the I-2, you say, no, you got to turn that into a residential thing. That's not going to happen.
Have you been
common
to,
sense?
Have you been you to that. Have you been to Wichita in the area that they've redeveloped down there?
Which one?
South Town.
Cowtown.
The South Town down by the new Intrust Arena and all the redeveloped.
That's where they're shooting
there.
Everybody.
Yeah, that's.
Yeah, I've been down.
Well,
there.
Last night I think there was a murder on Cherry Street.
Right,
a few years,
yeah.
And I guess they're still shooting in
Cherry
industrial
Street.
Areas
we don't
too.
Kill people there.
Yeah.
Well, I think that when you look at what things are existing and what they have the opportunity to be, I'm sure that people get killed in downtown Denver by the Rocky State.
Oh, yeah, it's
too.
All over the country.
But I think we'd love to have redevelopment to the extent that a lot of these areas have been able to bring in economic development, residential development, and that type of business, and that these areas do change. So,
well, again, with all due respect, that area, you're not going to get Todd Welsh or some other residential guy going there and scrape all that stuff out and build high-rises. All the housing stuff is to the southeast here. That's not going to be behind commercial stuff. It's not going to be behind the wild, wild west or whatever
and
it is out there.
I believe what you're describing is exactly what we've done over the years, and that is that we abandon our plans and say, well, that's a lot easier. So I think that's why we're in the situation we are now, because our plan has always been change the plan. So what we're talking about here, where I will completely agree with you, this isn't probably the most visible and far-reaching portion of this comprehensive plan, but when you nickel and dime and do that and pick and choose where you're doing, I think you get into troubles. I think we have a comprehensive plan, and we have to determine whether there is significant reasons to abandon that plan. And I think that's what we all sit up here and make the tough decision to, you know, whether it's good or not. I mean, I was completely honest about my feeling that, you know, it's hard to sit up here and say, geez, I'm sorry, but we're looking at trying to follow a plan here and do something difficult that we think will have long-term success. and I think what a number of other commissioners have mentioned and others is that we don't have a crystal ball. We don't know that all these decisions are going to be exactly the way they are, but I think we want to try and make the most reasoned and informed decisions that we can based on what we know about the sound planning principles that went into the plan.
Well, like I said, when you've got Roenick on the south, Wooster on the north, and you've got Perry with his I-2, and we have Mr. Deathridge in the center with a residential lot that you know, I know, it'll be a cold day in a lot of places before that ever happens. It's just not going to happen, period, in the sentence. Wouldn't you agree with that?
I don't agree with that.
You should.
I've listened to Commissioner Blanchard, and I think he has, I understand what he's trying to say. I think it's really a good idea, but I don't agree with him. I think we're keeping Mr. Deathridge from making a living, and I don't see that as a portion of an entryway to the city, and so I would agree with the recommendation of the Planning Commission.
Well, I guess I would look at it a couple of ways. I think it took a little bit of what I said. It's very easy to set up here, and if somebody comes to us, we say, oh, sure, you know, that area looks like crap anyway. Let's just go ahead and let him build it there. This area looks like this. Let's build there. And you know what? Every time we talk about closing a street, you know what we hear? The kids playing the street. It's the same arguments every time. Conversely, every time somebody comes before us and puts a piece of property, what do you think the first thing they say is?
There's no kids on this street.
It'll never be anything. It'll never be. It's horrible. You're holding us back from making our $1 million living. But you know, as a realtor, and so do I, location, zoning, all of those things play into the value of a piece of property. So you come in here, and you're asking us to rezone something to basically change the value of this guy's property, in a sense. He bought a piece of property that probably wasn't very valuable because of these conditions that are on it. So now you come to us and you say, change the comprehensive plan so my client, who you didn't sell the property to.
Yes, it wasn't my fault.
It wasn't your fault. Can make up for this bad, in a sense, bad real estate investment. And we get that all the time. I mean, that's really what's happening here. You're saying change the comprehensive plan so my guy can put up a lot. I agree. It looks horrible. But so does every lot that comes before us like this that somebody wants to make a change on. And at some point, we have to say, hey, look, we have a plan. We have to follow it. It's a tough decision, and maybe it doesn't seem right to you or to the gentleman who owns the property. But if we just allow every single person who comes before us and says, well, my property, I can't use it the way it is. It's you know, I can't do this, I can't do that. Then we end up with I-2 here and, you know, C-4 here. I mean, there's no rhyme or reason to the layout of the town. And what we're trying to do is comprehend.
That's why we're trying to get this changed now to where that section will be I-2. And I'm not saying that I bought the property saying I want to change it to industrial, you know. Or otherwise, if I would have known it was residential, we probably wouldn't even have messed with it.
Exactly.
See, because we would have left it as residential.
And that's my point. You wouldn't have bought it. But now you come to us and tell us change it to I-2 and add value to your property at the expense of 47,000 other people whose plan we're trying to protect. We're trying to make a better city. And we can't do that by spot zoning. And that's the whole point.
Well, this goes back to the city. When they zoned that, they had one lot that is surrounded by industrial property. You got one residential lot. That don't make a lot of sense, does it?
No, I think that whole area is zoned.
Respect, Jason.
That whole area is zoned residential, is it not?
No.
You've got most of it that's residential. That's what's called a legal non-conforming use. What happened is it was annexed to the city from Saline County with uses already on it, with the zone that it has, most of it, legally non-conforming. It was de-annexed and it was annexed again. In all honesty, there's a question as to whether it should have been annexed in the first place. But nonetheless, I'm sure the city was starting to wrap around a little bit, and that may have been part of it. And my point is that I think you do need to look broader, and I think you need to decide. I would agree. You're not going to see a house built on there at at this time or in the near future, particularly if there's nothing to the west, it's going to be residential. And so my point is that you still have to look long term. If we continue to give up on pieces of our community, you will never give them the opportunity to change. And when you really, there are many areas in our town that have changed in the last 20 years that someone maybe 30, 40 years ago would say, oh, you know, we're kind of done with it. It is what it is. That have become worse in that time. My thing is that whatever you do with that area, with that one lot and with that whole area, it should either conform with what you want to do out west or out east, whichever it is. And, the Planning Commission has said they don't believe that residential is the best long-term use of that area. It may be true, but if you decide to go industrial, it means you really should be looking at that. All that west area is industrial, and I wouldn't leave it open-ended so you can have the nasty, ugly, industrial that people can drive into town, mm-hmm. whether we like them to or not, on State Street, and see. You're probably looking at an industrial park or something that's nicer, that's more attractive as an entrance to your community. I wouldn't trash the area if you go industrial, but the point is we need to pick a long-term use, whether we believe an extension of commercial could be back there, whether it's residential or whether it's industrial, and that lot and the remaining lots should conform with whatever that long-term use is with the surrounding area, whatever it is. And it may be that you need to think more about that and look at the comprehensive plan further on that question. I don't know. I can't answer that. But I'm just thinking, I don't like the idea of spot zoning either. And in this case, Mr. Story's correct in that as far as the uses around it, there's no question about that. But it still is about what do you do up and down that north section, and are you going to sell it out as a kind of almost an unregulated industrial, or are you not? And once you make that choice, you're going to have a hard time going back on it. Mm-hmm. That's the thing. So whatever it is, just bigger picture.
Well, it seems to me it should be industrial. And I don't really understand all this like Commissioner Blanchard does, but it just seems to me it ought to be industrial.
I have two comments. I don't know that it matters if a farmer intends to farm the land until he dies. My guess is if some developer came to him tomorrow with a check for $10 million, he'd probably say, I'll sell. And whatever that price is, it may be, who knows. But there's a price. Everybody has a price. Wheat's only worth so much. And the other part is, part two of that equation, you bring a developer in that's interested, say a Todd Welch, who would come up to the podium and ask for the city's cooperation on this development that we are frankly interested in adding residential at some level. And all of a sudden, we would be very cooperative because this is an area that we want to have developed in a certain way, and so we are going to do all we can to make that a possibility.
Well, when I was talking to Mr. Gardner, he had mentioned that the city has tried buying that property from him a couple, three times.
And who had?
He doesn't want to sell it.
The commissioners, I'm not sure if the mic's picking up the comments from that distance.
Yeah, Mike.
For the benefit
at-home
of
players.
The folks.
Yeah, if you can come up to the mic, please.
You said there had been three offers, you said. Before
right, Mr. Yeah, when I talked to Mr. Gardner, he had said that the city of Salina even tried buying that property, and he wouldn't sell it. And Mr. Sharp, someone had approached him, and Mr. Sharp did not sell that property. So with me, with knowing Mr. Sharp and Mr. Gardner, if there would have been, an opportunity to cash in, he would have done it then. Instead
well,
of waiting until
have a son to deal with then.
Right.
And maybe his son won't mind retiring 30 years early.
Well, I imagine his son's kind of probably retired right now. So, but
And again, I I have no doubt that I don't know your other properties. You say you keep them up, and I don't know that you wouldn't. And it's again, I always try and point out when we say these decisions, it's not against you or what kind of business you would run out of there. It's an overall view, and I don't want you to think that we're saying, or at least a few of us maybe are saying, no, it has anything to do with a reflection on your business or you or whether you could make it an improvement. Probably it would look better if you went over there and did that. But I think we're still trying to look at the big picture, much bigger, not even this block, the entire Broadway corridor, and trying to look down there. And Mr. Story has his opinion of how things may grow and how they may not. But I think we just have to be really careful about any little thing that we do. And I pretty much think we either do what Mr. Gage says and look at the whole thing and say, okay, maybe it is better as I-2, or, you know, stick with a comprehensive plan. But again, I want to point out that there's no reflection on you. So,
my name is Dennis Roenick. I live at 1101 State Street in Salina. I own the property that is directly south of the property that they're talking about, and the salvage yard. We've had the salvage yard in our family since 1952. What existed in that property at the time that my father bought the property was a pig farm, and salvage yard was a dramatic improvement, I think, for Salina. Beyond past that point, I guess I do stand in support of Mr. Deathridge. Obviously, I have an interest in it. I don't intend to stop business on my salvage property unless somebody does write me a $10 million check, which would be nice. I would consider that. I'm trying to figure out what is undesirable about industrial property. That's what I keep hearing all of you say. To me, that brings jobs to Salina. Are you telling me that if a car manufacturer wanted to come in and develop that area in the farm field and bring 10,000 jobs to Salina, that you'd turn it down? Really?
That sounds a bit like the $10 million land offer, though.
Same. So we're talking about the same thing. I understand that you need to have future planning, but to hold up zoning on this property when everything to the north, everything to the south, everything to the west, if you think about the petroleum tanks that are out west, everything in that area is industrial. It's the destiny has been set for that area. So I'm all in favor of developing the Broadway corridor. I'm very proud of Salina. I grew up here. I think we're doing some wonderful things. But I do stand in support of this petition. Thanks.
And Dennis, for the record, not all of us said it was undesirable. Yeah. So don't lump us all in that category, please. I never said that.
Undesirable. I don't think anybody said I-2 in general is undesirable. I think there are certain areas of I-2 that are undesirable.
I see.
Yeah, I think if you, I think maybe the comments that I was making were not that industrial uses are undesirable. I do think that some of those properties don't look very good.
Yeah.
And if your property is directly south of that, I put that into it.
A lot of these properties
have fences that kind of block some of the junk.
Yeah, we didn't used to have a fence around our property. Now we do, at the guidance of the city of Salida, which I agree with. And if we're asked to do other things to improve the looks of the property, we're certainly willing to do that as a business to help Salina and to help our business. We have never failed to comply, and I'm all for that. Mr. Deathridge came into that property. Quite honestly, I went to that property myself and voluntarily cleaned it up because the owners in New Mexico weren't doing it. It looked terrible. When Mr. Deathridge came in, he dramatic improvement in the looks of that property. So far, he's done a lot of good. So, thank you.
Thank you. Yes, sir. Do we need to?
Do we have a mic? I gave you all a copy that you mull on, and there's some things in there that look like trash, but there's some things in there that's good.
Dead batteries?
It's like the structure on the health building. That might be the problem right there, that they continuously put roof on top of them because it's against the wall to take a roof off and put it in the dump. And against the law to take a roof off, an existing roof off, and put it in the dump. Started in, it's all in that deal I gave you.
Does that have to be 8.1?
Okay.
I'm just making sure.
Jordan, 821 Custer.
And I gave you a list there of what has happened in the last, 30, 40 years. We've got it's got worse all the time. Problem was this morning. I had an incident. The housekeeper didn't come that was there last week, and they brought a new one in, and this lady called me to the side, and she told me, we're very strict on this. You're not allowed to have no contact with her, make telephone calls or anything. She said, we're strict on this. And I said, well, what if I fell in love with her and wanted to marry her next week? What am I going to do, call off the wedding and lose my $20,000 I invested in? See, this is the kind of stuff that's going on telling people what the hell to do. And what I'm saying is, if you can form a group that believes this and does it, instead of putting it in a speech like Kennedy did, ask not what your country can do for you, ask what you can do for your country. You can change stuff around to where it'll work for the country. At the present time, a kid going to school and has a student loan, what I'm talking about on these concrete, them kids can do it. It's simple. Anybody that can read the back of a concrete sack can patch a damn roof. If you can read a sack and you can bend over, you can do it. And first one might not be perfect, but it don't take a myth to learn how to do it. But they can't do it because it's a lot of work. You with me? But that's what I'm getting at. It's against a lot of work. I can't work. I can't get a permit. I can't go out and pass some of my friend's sidewalk because I'm not allowed to. It's against the law for me to go out and pass a friend's sidewalk. Every damn thing just like that deal with that, I'm not allowed to talk to that woman.
Okay.
It's a joke, but what if I'm in love with her and want to marry her?
Okay, thank you. I do need to get back to the item that we had at hand, which is 8.1.
What's that?
I need to get back to the item that we were on, which is item 8.1, and we need to get to vote for that. I do thank you for your comments.
Okay, well, you guys mull this over, and what you can do is small groups can start them.
Right, thank you.
Work. Mm-hmm. All people want to do is work. So, if you get interested, give me a call. Let's get back to your item.
Thank you, Pete.
Thank you. Do I have any more public comment on this matter?
Yes. Lauren Mantle, Pleasant Hill Road. Mr. Hardy, I take exception to that there's a price for everything. Because I didn't put them wind towers on my property. Other neighbors have turned it down. They've turned down $300,000 a year.
Is this on item 8.1?
Yeah.
Okay. Because we weren't talking about windmills on item 8.1.
He made the reference. He opened the door.
I think it's just kind of a generalization. I think. Well, hey, I mean, it's. I think it's just a.
Yeah. Saying it, then you believe it.
Does anyone have any comments pertaining to item 8.1? Seeing none, I'll bring this back to my commission for a vote.
Gosh.
Madam Mayor, I move to deny requested comprehensive plan amendment. Based on our previous findings made September 9th, 2013.
Second.
Do we need to add the ordinance number in there or just deny that?
I think the denial is satisfactory.
Okay.
Okay, have a motion and a second. All those in favor?
Aye.
All those opposed? Aye. Motion carries 3-2.
Application, or item 8.2, application number. You don't have to do the item 8.2. Okay. Item 8.2.
He says pleasantly. Yeah.
Application number Z13-5, requesting a change in zoning district classification from RS to I2 on property addresses 1325 West State Street and 140 South Cherry Street.
Mr. Andrew.
Thank you, Mayor. Commissioners, the previous item is not completely dispositive of this matter because it is not illegal to rezone a piece of property in conflict with the comprehensive plan, but it is highly inadvisable, and that's why these things were ordered in the way they were. And so from a planning staff perspective, the intellectually honest thing to do is to start with what does the plan say about the area and is the zoning request consistent with that. And as we pointed out, this area was originally platted back in 1887. In 1930, the area dramatically changed because of the Broadway Boulevard was constructed as the US 81 bypass. As you see on this photo, there were actually portions of Dry Creek that were east of what is today Broadway. So the channel was straightened, Broadway was constructed, and then later there was a bypass channel for Dry Creek constructed even farther west as part of the levee project. And as was mentioned, this property was de-annexed in 1933, was re-annexed in 1971, and since 1977 has been zoned RS, which is residential suburban. And just by way of explanation, the city has two holding zones. One of those is RS, residential suburban, and the other one is A1 agricultural. And if you have a piece of property and you're annexed into the city and your property is not platted, then there's only two things that the property can be zoned, either agricultural or RS, because those essentially serve as holding zones. And so what was done is that even though this property was platted, basically everything out here was zoned RS. And so Mr. Gary Wooster has this property up here, and his land holdings there are approximately 27,000 square feet. And then you have this I-2 zone lot that is owned by Harley Perry, who does business as Perry Auto Repair on the other side of the creek. That property is 9,500 square feet. It is zoned I-2 and has been since 1978. And then you have the D&E Reynolds property right here. That has 26,000 square feet. So the total rezoning request area for these two parcels is 1.23 acres in total. And I think part of this starts with the annexation in 1971, but part of the area that is confusing and makes this area confusing is that in 1978, both the Planning Commission and City Commission approved a zoning change from RS to I-2 for this lot right here, and only that lot. And while the findings they made might be defensible, we would characterize what was done there as inappropriate spot zoning, because they should have been having this discussion in 1978 and not in 2013, and they should not have just looked at this one lot in isolation. They should have looked at the entire area. So it is the presence of that one I-2 lot that even made it conceivable or defensible to try to build off of that for these other two lots. If that I-2 lot wasn't there, I doubt if this application would have gotten this far. So again, this was an item that was originally, the Planning Commission was supportive of the I-2 zoning request for some of the same reasons. They thought it was more similar in character to this area here than the Broadway corridor, and that it was physically separated from the Broadway corridor. You disagreed with that and sent the matter back, and again asked the Planning Commission to focus on how expanding the I-2 zoning here could impact the future potential for residential redevelopment, both here to the east and here to the west. So the Planning Commission did that. Staff has looked at this every conceivable way to try to find a way where Mr. Dethridge might be able to use the property and not conflict with either the principles in the plan or the zoning classification. The Planning Commission did also, and they made one last attempt by saying, well, instead of I-2, we'll look at this C-5 over here that's on Broadway, and can he do the use he wants to do in a C-5, and can he do it in a limited plan C-5? And staff said, yes, that is a possibility. So they had attempted that, but there was a miscommunication and has been from the beginning that Mr. Dethridge consistently referred to paving the lot, but didn't actually mean paving the lot, but meant using gravel or asphalt millings as his surfacing. So the Planning Commission asked that a plan be worked up, which is this, which we mischaracterized this as asphalt surfacing, but the Planning Commission looked at this on October 1st and looked at perhaps doing a lesser change to a C-5 or plan C-5, with the plan C-5 basically limiting this property to one single use and requiring it that it be done to C-5 development standards. But Mr. Dethridge indicated he was not willing to conform with the C-5 development standards, which would require that this area that was used for fenced-in storage either be paved with asphalt paving or concrete paving. And so he then reiterated his request for I-2 zoning. Mr. Wooster also appeared and spoke at the hearing, but the Planning Commission, in their reconsideration, went back with the same rationale as they did on the previous item, and they said the area is too small to justify a map amendment, and again reiterated that they thought the entire area from Dry Creek over to the levee needs to be looked at, and look at what is the appropriate land use and the appropriate zoning for the entire area. So they submitted a modified recommendation to recommend denial of the I-2 zoning request, and again recommended a follow-up further study of the area to see if RS is in fact the most appropriate zoning classification and urban residential the most appropriate land use. So this originally had a recommendation for approval from the Planning Commission. They modified that to recommend denial of the I-2 application, and your options are you could approve the attached ordinance, which carries out a zoning change to I-2 on the Wooster and D&E Rentals property. And your other option would be to deny the requested zoning change, and that again can be based on the findings that you made at your September 9th meeting, and those findings are on page 5 and top of page 6 in your report there. That is findings you made on the 9th. So with that, I'd be open to any questions about the zoning aspect of this, but we are back with a request from the applicant for I-2 zoning, and it is just a case where we don't have any zoning tools that would allow Mr. Dethridge to use the property as he would like without changing the designation of the property.
What residential zoning is that RS most closely linked to? Just R1?
It is. It's got a minimum acreage. It's residential suburban. It's really designed to be almost an estates-type zoning. The only properties that we have are either holding zone properties or we have a few residential estate-type lots in the city that are 2 or 3 acres, and the RS really fits that designation.
And this is not even an acre, is that right?
I believe, looking back at the rationale, was that when this property is not platted, and so because it's in the city and it's not platted, it can only be one of two zones, and one of that is RS, the other one is A1. Mm-hmm. And I believe because there actually were a couple houses along here at one time that the RS was chosen instead of A1. Agricultural, but this property could just as well be agricultural as it is residential suburban. But that was the rationale. And as I pointed out, the only action or activity I've ever seen on this, I refer to it as the Sharp property because I owned it for so long, but the Planning Commission considered applications for platting and zoning that property for a Greyhound racing park in the late 1980s, and it wasn't licensed and nothing ever transpired, but that's the only thing that I can find that was ever proposed on the property.
So with the RS, I mean, I'm just, not that I'm encouraging, but what, or maybe A1 would be closer. In agriculture, that's purely agriculture. That doesn't include farm buildings or anything like that. I guess my point is, if this was agricultural land or this RS, is it possible, even though there's not a house built, that he could theoretically gravel an area, fence it, put his trucks in there, and still be conforming with either one of those zonings? Theoretically, I mean.
He would have to somehow tie that activity to something that could be deemed to be agricultural or agriculture and
related.
Yes.
And what's his business? So I guess I thought it was landscaping or something.
He is landscaping and also some tree trimming and removal. There are some things like nurseries. There are some things. Ted Long has property on East Cloud. It's zoned agricultural. He has a sod farm or turf farm there, and he has a house there, but it's also zoned A1, and that is an agricultural activity. But if it was zoned agricultural, it's more likely that you could get some uses related to nursery or horticulture or things like that. The former peony patch, that property is zoned agriculture, and they have a conditional use permit that allows for some limited fruit and vegetable sales and things there. But it would be, it would take some bending and convoluting to make his landscape and tree trimming into an agricultural type use, but certainly agricultural zoning would be closer than the RS.
I was just thinking back to their thought that maybe, you know, that we do one or the other, and agriculture is a good holding, that maybe this area does serve better as agriculture, but, you know, I wondered what kind of our threshold was for agriculture versus...
And part of it is just getting a good, which we tried to at the Planning Commission and can today, and it would be an opportunity for Mr. Deathridge to clearly describe what the nature of his business and activities are, and the clearer he can be, the better we can be at finding the proper home for that. But agricultural would be closer than the current RS.
So if he was growing sod, might be even better.
Right. Or if he had a tree farm or was growing sod or had fruits and vegetables that he was raising and selling or things of that nature, it's a little bit more of a stretch with the storage of landscape equipment.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Any other questions for staff? Any public comment? No? Okay. No public comment. I'd bring it back to the commission.
Madam Mayor, I would move that we deny the requested zoning change based on the findings made at our September 9, 2013 meeting.
Second.
Have a motion and a second. All those in favor?
Madam Mayor, may I make a comment before we take the question? Just on this, because I know there was, now that we've had a motion and a second, I'd like to, unless
we can
Commissioner
have a
Hardy
discussion.
Would like to say something first. I'd just like to point out that, you know, when we had our findings of fact on September 9th, I know that we took care in reading those four items into the motion. And as Mr. Andrew was going through those items, I think one thing that stuck out particularly strong to me today was number three, and that is that the previous spot zoning to I-2 for that small little rectangular parcel should not serve as a basis or justification for the I-2 zoning request. In fact, as Mr. Andrews stated, if that hadn't been done back when it was done, then we most likely would not be here, because there would not, the Planning Commission most likely would have found no grounds for this to take place. It's the perfect example of spot zoning, and I think it's why in a lot of places spot zoning is actually illegal. You can't even do spot zoning. So I think that's a particularly strong reason why, you know, as we look at what historically is there, well, just because it's there doesn't always mean it should be there. So I prefer to take a look, as number four would suggest, is that we look long-term at our future vision versus perhaps what the current uses are. Thank you.
Okay. So now do I go back to my motion and...
You can call the question.
Yeah. I think unless anyone has any other comments, you're certainly okay. Ready to vote.
Any other comments from commission? Okay, had a motion and a second. All those in favor?
Aye.
All those opposed?
Aye. Aye.
Motion passes 3-2.
Item 8.3, application number M13-8, requesting amendment to the future land use map of the comprehensive plan by substituting a parcel-based internally produced future land use map that would more clearly define the land use boundaries in the community for the current future land use map.
Mr. Andrew.
Well, we hope this will be viewed as a positive development as it goes with the implementation of the plan, but I'm going to ask John to put this up, and for lack of a better term, at least for the Planning Commission and others, we have described this as the fuzzy map, and this is the map that is currently in the comprehensive plan document. And the thing that you'll notice about it is that it does not have the property or parcel boundaries on the map, and it has some of the major streets, but it doesn't have a lot of the secondary streets, and property boundaries and street boundaries often form boundaries where you're trying to make a determination of what the future land use classification is on a particular property. So this future land use map is supposed to be a guide to future uses of land within the urban service area, but there have been times that staff internally and even struggling with Planning Commission and City Commission cases, you might have two individuals that would look at the map and might reach a different conclusion as to what it shows about a particular parcel. So while we were working with this, the planning staff had kind of a retreat where we went and took this and superimposed it on a parcel-based map and went through that and tried to iron out all the conflicts and nonconformities. And with the assistance of our GIS technician, we produced a map that had sharp edges and clearly defined boundaries, and we've been using that internally. And so we discussed that with the Planning Commission. They thought it would be a positive step if we could use that map for official purposes. And so, John, if you could go over to the same area we've been discussing on West State Street. So what you'll see about this map is it has the same color scheme, the same boundaries, all those things, but if you want to look at or find a particular parcel, like these are the parcels that we were discussing today right in this area, you've got the parcel boundaries on there, you've got the individual streets, and you can tell exactly what a particular parcel is. So the Planning Commission authorized us to initiate an amendment of the plans to substitute this map for the current future land use map so that it could be viewed officially and externally and not just internally. So it's based on tax parcels. It shows actual property lines and street right-of-way lines. It is consistent with the map that was adopted in September of 2010 with a couple technical corrections that we had an opportunity to make. John, if you could go to the conflict area map. I believe this was identified as either 5 or 6, but basically those were 10 areas that we pointed out that were shown as urban residential that were in some way commercial or industrial in use and in some cases zoning today. And so we called those out and the plan was knowingly adopted with those conflict areas on there. The only change is, if you want to go back to the proposed map, John, the only physical changes that we made on the consultant-produced map, they had essentially left out an oil tank storage area that was referred to out here that was in the deep in the floodplain but not shown as part of the conservation area. We fixed that. There was a piece of property that's owned by the Nordbo family on West Magnolia that's not in the floodplain, and it was shown as a conservation area, and we excluded that. There was a property between the Knox Sand Pit and South Ohio that both the Planning Commission and City Commission agreed should be urban residential, not suburban residential, at the time of adoption, but the map was never changed to reflect that. And then there were two changes that were made subsequent to adoption. One, John, if you could go down to the Yost Edition, which is at the Interstate 135 and Yost Drive. That is this area right here. It's formerly shown as commercial. That was amended to show that as an employment area. And then we determined that even though we had a case and discussion of it, that the map that staff had produced and all the conflicts ironed out, that the southeast corner of Centennial and Crawford was supposed to be shown as commercial, but on the map in the plan, that was never corrected to show that, so it still showed up as suburban residential. That has been corrected. The other things that are different on the internal map is that the East Salina Master Plan area, the Hospital Medical Master Plan area, the North Ohio Gateway Overlay District, and the South 9th Overlay District are all depicted on this map so that an external user could look at this map and say, where is the South 9th Overlay District? It's right here. And so that, we believe, is an improvement over the current map. We've identified some reasons why we think this substitute map would be beneficial. Number 5 is that having an internally produced future land use plan map will make it easier to keep up to date over time. That's the other large advantage, that if it's internally produced and there are updates or changes, having the map that we can control and update is beneficial. So the Planning Commission recommended that we adopt this map as a substitute for the existing 2.5 figure 2.1 in the plan document, which means we would substitute that. It would also take the form of a wall map in our office and would be placed on the city's website so that that it should be much clearer to look up and identify a particular parcel and see exactly what the designation is. So if you concur with the recommendation and findings of the Planning Commission, the ordinance as attached would substitute this map that you see there for the one that is currently in the plan document, and we think it would help with accuracy and with people seeing clear boundaries and also having the ability to modify it ourselves internally when a change is needed or an update is needed are all benefits to substituting the map. So I'd be open to any questions. I realize what you have in your packet's quite small, so that's why we've blown it up big on the screen.
Did you find many instances of spot zoning when you were going through this process?
Well, what we did is that we identified something on the order of 51 conflicts where the consultant produced map didn't reflect what was actually there or what it was actually zoned, and 41 of those were eliminated to make it better match. The 10 that were not eliminated are the ones that we showed you there. But yes, we do have a few instances of that. I don't think there are many that stick out quite so much as this single I-2 lot surrounded, but there are instances that our predecessors have seen fit to spot zone a piece of property. Again, it's in Kansas, it's not illegal, it's just highly inadvisable, and it's not good planning practice. So.
I appreciate the staff's effort in producing this map. I think it'll help anybody that has a question as to what the property is in the comprehensive plan land use designation. At least they'll be able to look at it from their parcel. So good job, staff.
It's got a few too many shades of purple on it.
Yeah. See
not,
that.
Not enough purple. But,
any other questions for staff?
Yeah, Dean, is anybody in our planning department colorblind? Not that we wouldn't hire them.
Might put triangles.
It just could make things a little difficult.
Be in the city manager's office, but I don't think that's the case with any of the planners.
Is that true?
And yes, that is definitely true.
Purple has many finite shades, and we can find a number of shades that we can use and enjoy.
And we may need to go to the Crayola Corporation for new names. Yeah, yeah.
Any public comment on this matter?
By Quist 2601 South Ohio. I just want to clarify a couple pieces of property and make sure that once we're doing this, I'm in good standing. Could you go to South Ohio, please? Two pieces. And Dean can probably answer this. How is this piece? Around Gary's head. Is that showing there?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That piece
is we reported, the southeast corner of Schilling in Ohio, there's a portion right at the corner that is part of a larger neighborhood center, and then out from there to the south and east is shown as future suburban residential.
Okay. Thank you, Dean. And John, could you go to the Markley and Magnolia? Please.
It's going to be to the right. There we go.
And this area right there, Dean.
That is suburban residential.
Okay. Thank you. Appreciate your time.
Thank you. Any other comments from the audience? Seeing none, I bring it back to commission.
Madam Mayor, I move that we adopt ordinance number 13-10721.
Second.
I have a motion and a second. All those in favor?
Aye. Aye.
All opposed? That motion carries 5-0. Before we get to item 8.4, I'm going to request a 5-minute break real quick. Yeah.
He does now.
All right, moving onward and upward, we're back to item 8.4.
Item 8.4, resolution number 137049, authorizing a first amendment to the Workforce Housing Development Agreement with Todd Welsh Incorporated relating to the proposed construction of basements in 7 of the 27 workforce housing units to be constructed in the Pheasant Ridge subdivision number 2.
Mr. Hobby.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. Mayor and Commissioners, you have before you tonight a request by Todd Welsh to amend the original agreement with the development of this Pheasant Ridge subdivision number 2. If you remember correctly, this was a 27-lot subdivision where we were working with workforce housing type units, and those units would all have a slab-on-grade type construction. Well, since January and the signing of that original document, we have completed the infrastructure work on this 27-lot subdivision. And one of the reasons why we have an issue before you today is the fact that in that 27 lots, the street elevation was raised to meet or exceed any floodplain issues we had in the community. The street was not lowered after we decided not to accept the housing and urban development funds, and therefore there is a need for some infill dirt in this subdivision. Mr. Welsh believes that there is an opportunity for him to develop 7 of the 27 lots by building basements and using the dirt from those basement areas to help him infill the balance of this subdivision. So therefore, Mr. Welsh came to us and asked for us to consider renegotiating the development agreement for this project in two different specific areas. The first area would be to allow 7 lots of the 27 lots to have built on them a basement underneath the house. And he has come to a decision that there's approximately $21,500 difference in the cost of the house. That brings us into the second issue that he'd like to amend. And the original agreement stated there was $140,000 maximum price for each one of the houses with a 3% adder on an annual basis. Well, with the additional cost of building a residential construction basement, putting in a floor system, the basement floor, the additional concrete work, and the various things that go along with putting in a basement, the stairway and handrails and those type of things, the cost of $21,500 he was requesting to add to the $140,000 base price. So we in this subdivision would end up with 20 lots slab on grade at a cost of not to exceed $140,000. You'd also have 7 lots with a cost not to exceed $161,500. And so those two amendments would be requested by Todd Welsh, and he is in the audience tonight to either further answer your questions, or you may ask questions of the staff if you feel free. But we'd ask for you to go ahead and approve the amendment to this development agreement.
Any questions for staff on this matter?
Is there a range of numbers for workforce housing? For price of housing?
We have never set a specific range other than this subdivision itself, and we worked with Mr. Welsh in the very beginning to develop the lots of slab-on-grade homes that have a little higher energy efficiency, so they'd have a little lower costs, long-term costs to the owners themselves. And we set that cost originally at $135,000, and before the development agreement was completed, it went to $140,000 because of the lapse of 1 year period of time. So we have set internally the $140,000 price range.
Is there an average price for a single family home in Salina?
That I cannot answer for you. Mr. Welsh is a realtor or may be able to answer that question for you much more readily than I can.
Yeah. Commissioners, we can say, and again, it depends which which development you're in, and it goes back to the question of kind of stratification, what we typically see built. If you're in the, I think, the Magnolia Hills area, I think the average cost, I'm going to say, is probably upwards of $275 and up. Mr. Welsh had a subdivision out on just off of West Schilling about 2 years ago, I think, that was developed, and I believe is all but built out, if not built out. And those were very similar probably to these houses, although these may actually be a little better efficiency-wise. I think those were in the 130s to 140 price range, and we really looked at those as from a new house perspective, as close to an affordable house or really probably a second home buyer house as we could get to. The houses down along the East Schilling area on the north side, I think those range, and I'm going to look at Gary, I think those range in price probably from about 175, 180 upwards, about 200,000, somewhere in there. Those do have basements, I believe. So that gives you an idea in the kind of three basic areas where we've seen three or four areas we've
I
seen.
I guess the other question then would be on the workforce side of the equation, is there a salary or annual wage that you would attach to a workforce person?
You work back with some numbers on that.
We work backwards with the numbers, thinking that somebody in the $15 to $20 an hour range would be able to afford this type of a house at $140,000.
What's that equate to for an annual wage?
Excuse me?
What's that equate to an annual wage?
Yeah, 30 to 40,000, if you're 15 to 20, somewhere there.
But just for clarification, the development agreement itself does not put any parameters on the purchaser
or
their incomes or resale. It was just really the price point of the home.
So we were given quite a bit of a wide berth as far as figuring out what's actually affordable. It wasn't a percentage of what the median income is off of a census tract. I noticed that we've got 118,000 from HUD, or originally 118,000 from HUD, 243,000 from EPA, and 130,000 from North Central Regional Planning Commission. Those being grants, generally with grant funds, you're held to keeping things within something that they would prescribe as.
Correct. They would describe that as 80 to 120% of a median range. So we feel like that in that $40,000 range to $50,000 range for a family would be eligible to fit into a home of this nature.
And so the RFP was based on those, on basically, so let's go for the high number, $40,000.
It was developed more on the cost of the housing than it was for a house approximately 1,100 to 1,200 square feet, slab on grade with some energy efficiency considerations, with a small amount of special assessments to be added to
the
house.
And at the time, that was a $135,000 house.
Correct.
With a roughly $6,700 special.
Correct.
Correct? And I take it that the specials were brought down because of these grants. They were specials were subsidized.
That's correct.
Okay.
The infrastructure was subsidized by the grants.
And so that would, just on that rough math, that would make a $143,700, roughly, house was the target we were going for in the RFP.
Correct.
Okay.
Any other questions for staff? Anything from the audience? I see you coming up here. Distracted by the sirens. I think they're coming for Martha, but she's already gone.
Yeah, thank you for your time. My name is Todd Welsh, 221 South Morris Drive, and thank you for your time in hearing this. I'll give you a little update on the project. As Mr. Hobby has said, the street, curb, gutter, and sewer, water are in. BoreTech is out there currently putting in the electricity for West Star. We hope to come in front of you for building permits in the next 3 weeks to start our first four homes. Our first four homes will be along Quail Hollow, which are the bottom left-hand corner. We are going to be building a model home there and putting in three bedroom homes and two bedroom homes in there, listed at $139,900. If you've driven the area, you've seen that we do have the billboard up. So $139,900 is the price that we'll be going on the market at for those. How this came about on the yellow area that's there Again, our intentions were not to have basements at the very beginning. I was hoping that if you had some time, if you received your packet to drive out there, I had George Garacki go out and shoot an elevation from curb. My understanding is because of the elevation of the road, what needed to be brought in, and scraping some of the dirt, they got it from that backside. If you were to walk out there, there's a green post sitting out in the middle of the lot. And we shot the elevation, and the top of curb to that green post to the middle of those back lots was 3 foot. So building of a home of a slab grade to get actual the driveway, so you can get drainage from the driveway, we need to be a foot above curb. That's 4 foot. So you can imagine of bringing in the fill on the back side of that. So for a couple of reasons, could it be done? Sure. It would be the last lots I would develop and have to find some dirt to be brought in at different times, and hoping that over the cost years that that could be done. One thing that we have noticed with having the sign out there is we do have families moving in from out of town who have families, and the number one thing is for basements, for them to look at it. So there's that reason. There's also, and we feel like we're still hitting the workforce housing. Todd Welsh Inc. is not making one penny more by having the basement in there. That's why we received the bids from George Garacki by there. It really is. I really come for you in saying that I wouldn't want to live on a house that's got 4 foot of fill on it, of a slab and grade. My intentions, if I'm going to put this name on it and for the city of Salina, is to have a great community that doesn't have problems later on when they bring Brookwood across through there. I just wouldn't want to come in and bring in 4 foot of fill and do compaction tests and have any problems with those slab on grades versus a traditional basement that's there. And I would add to the numbers that you have there, I did put $240,000 of my own money in there to qualify for those grants. So I don't want you to think that all of that was done. I wrote a check for, is that correct, $240,000 and some change to help bring those specials down to make this development go through.
Thank you, Todd.
You mentioned that you're listing those at $139,900. Mm-hmm. What are the... I know from following this project through from June of last year and that this actually isn't the First Amendment. We actually got rid of the original agreement and went to the agreement that we're now making the First Amendment to. And Mr. Hobby had mentioned to it, too, that the elevations were part of the reason for needing the basements was you needed dirt. And you had mentioned it too to build up the elevations. Mm-hmm. And could you maybe walk us through just a little bit of why that first change was there? Because that 135 actually went to 140, mm-hmm. and then also in conjunction with that, the specials went from 6,700 to 18,000. Is that correct?
That is, we don't have the actual numbers yet completed on the special assessments, but that could be in a neighborhood where they'd be about one half of what the normal assessments for their normal lots in the community would be.
When we sent that out for bid, I felt we did great in bidding that. The bid came in around $600,000 for all concrete, which was lower than the engineer's estimate of, got up to be about $1 million. And so it came in right at $700,000 for concrete. That is there, but the difference of the 135 to 140 is we lost the HUD grant, or we chose not to accept the HUD grant that was there, the $115,000. Mm-hmm. So we did not take that HUD grant, given that there were certain things that needed to be done, heavily burdened on staff's time and to that development. So we decided collectively that HUD grant was not received.
You're referring to the eight additional step process to determine that no other project sites were available? Is that the...
That is correct.
Okay.
Housing and Urban Development had some contingencies that were quite strict that they developed as they found out which site we were working on. So.
And at that time, it was determined that what that brought was that we were dealing with floodplain here. Is that correct?
A very small portion that runs through there. And HUD, to get any type of HUD funding, which we found out, correct me if I'm wrong, Mr. Hobby, is not only does it have to be out of the floodplain, it has to be a foot above curb floodplain, and then the top of foundation has to be an additional foot. So that's 2 foot above curb all the way through there. So floodplain to HUD and true floodplain could be two different things. It wouldn't be considered in the floodplain, but HUD, to receive money from them, even has a higher floodplain elevation.
Well, and to clarify that a little bit further, we went into this project expecting that the drainage work would allow us to do a letter of map amendment and change the floodplain. What really kind of caught us by surprise from HUD's perspective is they wouldn't acknowledge the letter of map amendment. If it was ever in a floodplain, they wanted it treated as a floodplain, which is a deviation from your more typical application of FEMA regulations. It's actually being more conservative than is required by FEMA regulations.
So is the additional cost of the specials that went from the roughly $6,000 because you're not getting the, and if I understand right, wasn't the $118,000 dealing with land acquisition and engineering?
That's correct. It could be for planning or land acquisition, or, well, their 80% could go towards land. 20% of the grant funds could be used towards engineering.
Right, and that wasn't completely lost, but because isn't the $5,000 off of the $135,000? Added into being able to carry that land cost clear to the end of the project, and then you being able to roll that $5,000 into the sales price. Is that right?
That is correct. Okay. Yeah, we lost the $118,000, $115,000, and to make up that difference is I let that go back. So I basically, when you looked at the whole project from the beginning with my financial institution, again had to then borrow another $118,000 to carry on over a 3 to 5 year period, exactly what you're saying, for the length of the project. That's there. Hopefully to recoup that back at $5,000 yeah. per home.
At $5,027 is $135,000, so that'll be covered. The additional cost, though, of the specials, is that due to the floodplain issues that you had to elevate the road higher to, or why exactly would the special assessments then be so much higher than that $6,700? Why? I mean, if we're getting the $5,000 on the back end of the property, so losing that was nothing.
If you look at the initial RFP, our initial estimate to do this project was about $500,000. That was bids that were actually went out and received from APAC.
Mm-hmm.
So it was right around $500,000. Well, we're $200,000. As the longer we waited to go, it's a couple hundred thousand dollars more. Now, again, I'm not the master of inflation or know what's going on, but I had legitimate bids from APAC for $500,000, only to turn out later that APAC was even higher than the other bid, real close, don't get me wrong. Real close to that, but it went from $500,000 to $700,000 to put in the infrastructure there with not a lot changing. I mean, I don't believe that, and again, anybody in here who's along with this project can jump in and tell me, but I don't believe that anything that was found through topos or elevations or HUD coming in with anything drove the cost up as per this site because of adding of the dirt. The dirt that was added was either added from on the same site, and or I provided dirt off of some existing property that I own that was brought over to the site. No outside fill dirt, to my knowledge, was brought into the property that would add any additional cost to raise the streets out of the floodplain.
What I'm trying to figure out here is how it is then that your infrastructure is at such a greater elevation than what you need it to be, because you had mentioned before in one of the other items that site slopes off, and you're having to bury a lot of that infrastructure 19 feet deep. So I mean, you'd want to have that down as low as you might be able to do it engineering wise. I would think it'd be more cost effective.
Well, we're talking about two different pieces of land. The 19
well,
feet.
No. I'm just saying in general, if that's the general lay of the land out in that area that you're dropping off, I assume that this also kind of drops off in that same general fashion. But it just seems that why would you build that road and infrastructure so high if you had always planned on having those slab on grade?
Yeah, it's a great.
Originally, the stormwater program was required the roads to be elevated in order to take the runoff from the houses and the road into the detention area there without having to spill 100% of the water out into the neighbor to the north. or across Brookwood when it is actually developed. So that retention area along the back side was changed and modified. There was pipe that was put into the project that had not been originally designed in the original bids, and the detention pond was reduced depth. The depth was made deeper in order to carry the water and runoff. So the streets had to be elevated enough to get the water to run off to the back side, or to basically back to the west, northwest corner of the property.
Commissioner Blanchard, one of the expenses that would be from there is on the back side that Brookwood is not created yet, is he's talking about a drainage tube that goes along the very back side of those yellow lots that are there. That was added later. The initial plan was to come in to have an open ditch concept, and as it went further along through the process, city staff looked at it and said, okay, if we're really going to bring Brookwood through here, and do we really want to have an open ditch concept? So as that continued to change, as we went progressing all the way through, they're adding more benefit to there. Also, the price went up as well.
So I'm just trying to get, while you guys were talking about specials and stuff, I'm trying to just get my head around the pricing. So the $139.9 does not include the specials. They're not paying the specials up front.
That's correct.
And the total of the specials are?
Unknown at this time. We
estimate?
I would love to estimate. I don't even have I'm not even sure. I mean, I've heard anywhere from $9,000 to $14,000, so depending on the size of the lot and where it's at. So I really don't know, Aaron.
So really these houses are anywhere from $150,000 to $155,000. Because a special is not a tax, it's actually a loan against property money you owe. So, I mean, the truth is, doing my calculations, if somebody made $41,044 a year, which is listed as our average income into Salina, and only had $250 a month in debt, they could borrow about $139,000. So if that's our average wage, and that's what the average person could buy, so you're $15,000 over that to start. No, you're... Yeah, 15 over that and above. I mean, I begin to question, I mean, the workforce numbers anyway, which I had a problem with before. I have a hard time seeing our average home costs in Salina are $114,703. I bet if we actually looked at what was sold last year, that number's probably closer to $107,000. That's just our average taxable townhomes, homes, just kind of an average look ahead at that. It's just always hard for me when we start talking about workforce this and workforce that, when the median, when it's almost half again as much, or at least a third of what the average home in Salina is, and now we're talking about adding another $21,000 on basements, these things, and it's no longer workforce housing. That's well above our average selling price. I mean, this money, I think the whole concept of taking this money was to try and make a development that's affordable, that's efficient, that's and that 135 even at the time sounded high. Now we're talking about getting into houses that could be theoretically 161,000 before you even get to the specials. There could be additional 9 to 14,000 above. You're talking now. You're up to $180,000. That doesn't seem very workforce to me. I mean, that seems really expensive, and I'm just wondering. If we know that 41,044 taps out at 140,000, that's considering they only have $250 a month in debt. Now, you show me somebody out there making $15 to $20 an hour, even a single person who only has $250 a month in debt. I just took what was into the calculator.
So that you're calculating a single user, double, not husband and wife both making X amount of dollars?
Right. I mean, and that's, so
single,
and that's true.
Single guy.
That's true. I'm just saying just looking at the single person, it caps out at that. Again, we're now...
Well, you're using a lot of ratios. I'm just using ratios of dual income. I don't
sure,
know dual
sure,
income,
but we're still income. We're still 65,000 above the average, or more above the cost of the average house in Salina.
I believe, Aaron, in doing this every day, and I think somebody could probably come in front of you and build a house for $80,000 or $90,000. I don't think you would want to see it 5 years later. Could we have done this for less expensive? Sure. But the RFP required and said, look, how do we take what you did out of Stone Creek and make it even better? And we ran the numbers and said, okay, we're going to give you higher efficiency, 90% efficiency. We have to do more insulation. We have to do all of these extra things to this particular property. And that was done through the RFP. Mm-hmm. That wasn't saying, Todd, how cheap can you build me a house and throw up some lapboard siding and some cheap windows and put up there and get it for $120,000 to meet workforce housing. Mm-hmm. That wasn't the idea. The idea was, how do we get a great house that we can put in a nice area that's a little bit subsidized, that you get some grants and you put the money in there, and we put the RFP together, and I'll stand up here and say I think it's going to be a great addition. I think it's a great project. I believe that you cannot move here from outside the town and have the option. Sure, you got an option to buy a $250,000 house in Magnolia Hills. You got 100 or 220 in Wildcat, and you got 240 on Eileen and Eastview and everywhere that's there. But you do not have an opportunity to buy a new home for your family for $161,500 other than that area right there.
But I think it comes back to exactly what you said. It was an RFP. And when you were awarded that contract, it was you could build a $135,000 house. Now we have houses approaching $180,000.
Well, but everything changed inside there.
I didn't
change it. I didn't change it. I'm working with the parameters that are given to me.
You're coming to us asking us to allow you to build basements down here. So, I mean, I would think that that is a change. I mean, the whole concept of this was $135,000 house. So you could stand up here and tell us exactly what you're telling us. And that is, you know, families can move to town, buy a new, efficient, affordable home for $135,000. But that's not what we're getting. You're coming to me telling me we're going to have seven houses out there that are probably going to be $180,000 or more.
No. Then what I'd like to tell you.
Well, commissioners, hold on a second. First of all, we're rehashing the whole last action that was approved on this item. And you can do that if that's what you need to do to get to this particular question. But here's the thing. Staff created the RFP. Staff determined. We said to ourselves, what house price do we think is reasonable for what would be considered a dual income? We didn't use the word affordable because nobody knows what the definition of affordable is, but a workforce housing, and there's a presumption in all that the workforce housing is typically a second home buyer situation, not a first home buyer situation. And that all came way back when the chamber submitted a grant for EPA and HUD and all that. So some of that was sort of predetermined at that time. And so then we came back, we put together the RFP, we talked with all the potential folks we thought might be interested in it. We had multiple proposals. This came in as a, Dodd's proposal came in as the best proposal at the time. And one of the things we said is we want this to be more energy efficient than a typical house would be. We also said we want nicer finishes than you might expect to get in a $130,000 house in Salina, Kansas. You don't really see a lot of new $130,000 houses, but we in other words, there are houses in other communities that have built where they don't have good inspections, and you can see when the snow melts, you can actually see the warpness of the roof and where the roof trusses are. We don't want that. So these houses were intended to be a slightly higher quality. And I say slightly, actually maybe quite a bit higher quality as far as the building materials, the finish work inside, and the energy efficiency, because we don't, as a community, we haven't talked about energy efficiency in our codes. It's what the standard code is, but we said these can be a higher energy efficiency, and there's a little bit more cost to that. And so we put that together. That wasn't dictated by the developers in any way. That was us trying to just figure out the right target. We may have hit it. We may have missed it a little bit. And then, so if you look at that, the original target was 135. That's correct. And then we had a time delay from the time we actually were able to estimate that to the time that we actually had the contract and the ability to move forward with the project. That's the 5,000 right there. And then you throw in the HUD issues. There was a bust on the original estimate, from the original estimate to the actual bids. But you throw in the HUD changes and all that. Yeah, you're looking at $140,000 house, 139.9, call it 140, with about $21,000 for those seven. Plus specials, which again could range anywhere from 8 or 9 to say 15, and that's what you're looking at. The point of it all is that we've looked at it. Our engineers have looked at what Todd's engineers have done, and he really doesn't have a lot of options for those seven at this point in time. That's really the last piece of this whole thing. And I mean, quite honestly, because of wanting to keep the road at what we believe is really a proper elevation, based on the whole thing, it puts him in a real position with that. Let's say that we leave those houses the same, and we have some strange elevations back there, but we bring in fill dirt for the road. There's a cost to hauling that fill dirt, so it's going to come back into it, and he'd be right back with the request, and it might be more because you're not able to borrow from the site. You're going to have to transport it further, so you actually could have a higher overall cost that's attributed to all the lots as a request. Doesn't mean you have to approve it. Rather than just focusing on the seven and putting basements in those seven. The thing with this is that it doesn't change our participation at all. It only changes the price that he can charge for just those seven lots because they're going to have basements. That's really the only aspect here. the city doesn't put in a dollar more to the thing. And I think Todd mentioned that he wanted to get the quote so you would recognize that that quote is the dollar figure that's going to cost. Therefore, that's the impact to the pricing. So there's not an extra profit, you know, extra 10% or anything like that built into it. That's what the cost will be. That cost will be passed on. So it should show up exactly like that. It's not really many choices we really have at this point in time because there's going to be a cost to deal with the elevation. In the end, I think we have to evaluate this because this was very conceptual from the very beginning. Very, very conceptual. And so we struggled with what is the price range? Can it be built for that? What do you get for that? Who can afford to be in there? We really struggled with that because it's not a really easy question, quite honestly. And the more we looked at it, we struggled with trying to create a project that got us somewhere to that. That part was on us. That was on city staff trying to figure out the target, knowing it could move a little bit, too, and trying to keep it in there. Now, these are market houses. There's no qualification. There's no income limit or anything like that. But we said we're lacking as a house sort of in this price range. Let's see if we can build it and then see what kind of market we have for it. So this is a very experimental deal, and it was all prompted by the federal grants and working with the chamber to try to initiate doing something that we thought was needed in our community. We may look at it in the end and say, maybe we don't want to do it anymore. Todd may look at it and say, I don't want to do it anymore. We don't know, but I wouldn't get too hung up on this because he's doing what he can with that site based on the parameters he worked under for us, in essence. I think it's important for you to know that.
Thank you.
Well, I appreciate that, but it's still the question still is that if correct me if I'm wrong, but we've been working on this for 7 years to get a workforce housing. I mean, this started 6-7 years ago. I heard it was part of the chamber strategic plan and kind of rolled with that, and it just seems like the price on these workforce houses keep going up. So I think there's a little bit of relevance there, but My thing is like when I read the recitals here and it doesn't say we need to do these basements because we didn't think about the elevation of the road versus the slab that we were going to build there, and so we're off considerably here. It says to increase marketability and diversity. So I guess that we need diversity to me would suggest, and I may be wrong, but we need some houses with basements and some houses on slabs to make it, the overall development, more marketable. I don't see where that is a fact, unless I'm missing something. All I'm seeing is that we've gone from 135 to 140, now to 161.5. And the number I heard on the advisability part of the special assessments is that they could easily be in the neighborhood of 18,000. So that gets us pretty close to 180,000. And I believe one of the residents that was near your, that had spoke up against your plan had said these are going to be $178,000 houses, and you said no, they aren't. Well, I think that she was right. I think they are going to be $178,000 houses. Now, I think the price is what the price needs to be for you to do them. If it needs a basement because it's going to look completely ridiculous to have a house down that far, then perhaps that's the best thing that we need to do. But I think that I applaud everybody that worked on trying to get the energy efficiency in there, and because that's a big deal with affordability. It's a big thing about being able to ongoing affordability. But it just seems like I think a lot of residents are going to look out there and say, 161.5, that's affordable? What are these guys are all out of touch. And so I think when we are a bit aghast at, you know, we all of a sudden affordable in Salina, Kansas is now, some would argue, $160,000 to $180,000. I think that it's a bit alarming to me at least. And so I don't mean to rehash all the stuff, but I think it's important to see where we started and where we are. And I think we're quite a ways apart for a lot of people's ability to afford these.
There's 48 houses. I just did a realtor.com. I guarantee there's more on the Salina MLS. There's 48 houses for sale between 125 or 135 and 175. And they're on streets like Country Hills with 2,200 square foot, Gale Drive. I mean, there's a lot of nice houses on here that are much, much more than I think you're probably going to offer. Maybe not the energy efficiency. And those aren't in areas that most people would consider affordable. I don't think most people look at Country Hills Road and said, yeah, that's where, again, we don't want to use affordable. That's workforce housing. That's where we'd expect to see somebody making $15 an hour. I don't think people look at those streets like that. Here's another Country Hills, Blakemore, maybe. Sunset, I mean, we look at any of these things, and that's supposed to be, I mean, these are our, whether we like it or not, these are getting to be towards our upper end houses price-wise. I don't think you'd take somebody into, a 2,200 square foot house on Country Hills Road and say, this is your garden variety workforce housing. These numbers have just gotten, I think, out of control. And if anything, it should be a lesson in these projects. I really don't see where your project's any different than any other contractor. How is your, all of a sudden, your product, workforce housing, and Kelly Dunn's or whoever's doing Wildcat, how is that any different? Your prices are the same. So why aren't they called workforce housing? How come they didn't get $400,000 worth of grants? I mean, what's the difference between your development and Wildcat Circle, where these things are selling for $165 or $169?
Because they're selling for $165, $169, and the same house will be $139. Now, if you can't see that difference, I'm not quite sure how to make that difference. There's $169 and $139. So that's $30,000 difference. The difference between that development and my development
is there's no specials on Wildcat Circle. There's specials on yours.
So how much are the specials that we just talked about? They're $9,000. So $139 plus $9,000, which is cheaper, $169?
Well, we can dip down to the 150s as well. I mean, look. And see what's on here.
Any more questions for me? Thank you for your time.
Well, I think just what he may have been getting at is that $18,000 for that special represents a subsidy brought in to bring that special down to $18,000. And I believe that Mr. Hobby had stated that represents roughly half of what. So that may be what Commissioner Householder was referring to, is the roughly $32,000 or whatever an average assessment is on that type of lot.
And how do we get this far along and not know what the special costs are? I mean, how do we start all this construction?
Until we have all the grants accepted, we don't know exactly what that final dollar is going to be. We just today, breaking news here, received $243,000 from EPA, federal government's back in action again, and they gave us our money today. We're still waiting on $130,000 from North Central. We know we're not going to have $118,750 from HUD.
And I would add to that, regardless of grants, the special assessment project, the resolution of advisability is based on construction cost estimates prior to bidding and actual construction and completion of the project. So the final step in any special assessment project is to take the actual realized cost and then turn them into the special assessment.
And I could understand that given $1,000, $2,000, but I'm hearing, well, it could be $9,000, it could be $14,000, that seems pretty, I mean, you're talking differences of 35%. I mean, how can you be that far off? Besides, you do this every single day. I mean, you're coming to us as the expert saying you do this stuff, and you're telling me that it's okay to have a 35, 40% price difference in what your estimates were, and you didn't know these lots were going to be high. And I mean, it just seems to me, like I said, you place yourself up here as the expert, but you come to us with, we didn't know this, we didn't know that, we didn't know this was going to happen, we didn't know that was going to happen. I mean, it seems to me like I had to get out of the music selling business and get in the development business, because Salina seems to give to developers who obviously don't have the entire plan laid out and everything done correctly before they, it's sort of like, what's the ready, fire, aim? I mean, it seems to me like this is, I mean, that we're just wildly off on our estimates here, and guess who gets to pay for it again? The taxpayer. I mean, where's this money coming from? How's the federal government funded that's giving you that money? From taxpayers.
But what I'm asking for does not cost the city of Salina, the taxpayer, or the federal government one more penny.
It costs the home buyer.
Yeah, that's
different than the taxpayer, though. The home buyer
gave you the $400,000 to make this affordable housing.
You didn't give us affordable housing. You've given us houses that are going to range from 160
if you have
to 180,000.
I disagree with what you're saying on there. I appreciate it, but I'm not going to take ridicule of whether what you consider workforce housing unaffordable to what the general public believes is workforce housing in this project. Thank you for your time.
Well, we'll just discuss
Thank
it without
Todd.
You then. So,
Commissioners, if I may, just to be sure that everybody understands how it was the introduction of the concept of the utilization of special assessments in this project occurred, it was at my recommendation. We're dealing with grants from the United States government. I don't know a whole lot about the administration of grants. I just know that from a legal standpoint, you better be sure it's in the bank before you assume anything. We anticipated that there were variables. We knew there were going to be variables because we had estimates of the cost of the improvements, but we didn't know what the ultimate bid price was going to be. I looked at it, and we would have had the most circular arrangement you could have possibly had if we had either the city having to wonder how much it had to ultimately pay, or Mr. Welsh and his corporation wondering how much they would ultimately have to pay. The only variable that seemed workable in the system and that has been there ever since we originally laid out the plan was the utilization of special assessments as the variable. It also enabled the city to be the contracting entity for the purpose of construction of the improvements. That, I won't bore you with all the details, but did simplify 1,000 times the administration that would have been involved if you did it the other way. You had Mr. Welsh having to qualify for the granting and his proving what he did, and anyway, it was much simpler for the city to enter into the contracts for the improvements so that the city then was the recipient of the grant. So I hope that helps everybody understand what prompted the introduction of the, we knew we had variables,
right?
And the utilization of specials at that time just simply seemed to be the only way to manage to those to the unpredictability of right. what we were dealing with.
And having gone through the entire process, having the different times this has come before this board and planning commission that came before, That was very well spelled out there. At that time, though, the specials were $6,700. And my only right. point is not the advisability of the specials, because I understand why those are being used. My comments are just reflective of the fact that they continue to go up. And my other comment on them was just to try to clarify perhaps what Commissioner Householder was talking about. Under a normal circumstance, the developer would have been responsible, or the future homeowner, for 100% of that special, but they were brought down, which helps to make them affordable by the grants and the other assistance being put forth.
Well, and not hopefully belabor the point, but that was also why it was helpful. The grants all were directed, as you might recall, to the improvements. So that was also how the dovetail between the grants and specials as the means of trying to anticipate and be prepared to deal with the variables rather than having to look to the city or to look to any other possible source. But I just hoped everyone recalled that was the genesis of the utilization of the special as kind of the safety valve, if you will, recognizing it does fall to the home purchaser. There's no question about that. But that was the only variable we had in the picture that we could avail ourselves of.
Yeah, and commissioners, the spec of the house, again, we dictated a good part of that mm-hmm. through our process. I mean, there were some variables, but we dictated that, we accepted that, and they utilized competitive bids. So, sure, there's a question about the elevation. And there's a question about that dollar amount, but basically everything that leads up to that, with the exception of the grant, and then there's that delay factor, which delays can, who knows what happens in a delay typically. A lot of times it's a higher cost. It's fairly typical. But when we're talking about the layout, when we're talking about all that, most everything we've accepted, we've reviewed, engineers reviewed it. There was a bust. There's no question there was a bust in that. That happens sometimes. Sometimes it doesn't, but it does sometimes. you know, that's not Mr. Welsh. It's his problem because he hires the person who's supposed to do it, but he's not calculating that himself. So, I mean, that's what we had to deal with. But he's done everything that we've expected him to do in submitting for this. And then, as you, like I said, as you get into it, if you say, oh, we've got a problem, we've got this or we've got that, we try to deal with it. And don't get me wrong, if you're frustrated that there was an engineering bus, I get that. Everyone is, including the owner. But everything else leading up to that followed the process that we established. So I want to reiterate that. That's very important. And again, this is a bit of an experiment trying to see in Salina, Kansas, in our market, you know, with the contractors that might be interested, with land prices, with all these factors we've been talking about, what's worked for us and what's reasonable for a long time. This was an opportunity with the grant money to try to see where that ended up, not knowing for sure if we'd hit the target or not, hoping we would, but, you know. And, yeah, I think we're a little above the target, and if you go basements on those are going to be a little above that target, a little more above that target for 7 of those 27 or 8 homes. That's very, very true. But that's part of why we wanted to do this, to see, is there a means for us to utilize federal dollars to bring housing costs down and get a little higher quality house than you might get for that same price. And that was the difference, too. We knew some of it would be absorbed in the quality because of the type of insulation, the cabinetry, everything. We really respect a lot of the roofing materials and the energy efficiency, which we set at a higher level. So we knew there were going to be variables and all that.
But you keep mentioning the things that were there, but that was all in the RFP before Mr. Welsh bid on it. He knew what he was getting into, and he gave us an estimate of what he could do it for, and he can't.
Well, I mean, aside from the bus, you're correct. There was the time frame, and then there's that the bust on the elevation question that was kind of prompted. Again, part of that was in response to the HUD requirement on the road elevation. And I'd tell you, I think the road should be above the floodplain elevation myself. I think that's good planning. So if we were able to scratch it, start all over, and then redesign and reconstruct it, you could have lower roads. Well, it's not in that. We don't have that option right now.
If not for this development that's going in now, would this project even be deemed feasible to develop if it weren't subsidized? I mean, maybe Mr. Welsh can answer
that price range.
I mean, at all. I mean, could you put basements in there without special engineering and considerations? And
I think you probably could put basements. I'd have to defer to Todd on that. You could generally put basements at that location in town without a problem, couldn't you? Yeah.
Okay. So.
And
oh, sorry.
Yeah, I'll just finish this up. So I think the question, it seems like we sidestepped the whole, this was the reason why we need basements is the engineer might have messed up a little bit.
Well, I think there was a calculation error somewhere or I don't know if something was unforeseen. I can't tell you exactly what caused the situation where we said, hey, we need more dirt, and then the basements are a good opportunity to get that because it's probably the most cost-effective means to bring dirt in because it's already on the site, and then convert that into a basement home versus to leave them all slabs and then haul dirt, buy dirt, and have it pay the transportation cost to haul it in. That's what I presume that they went through in the thinking.
And so that would, if it weren't for the engineering snafu, they wouldn't need to do basements. Okay, but that still makes those.
Just because of the engineering snafu is not the reason for a basement or not to have a basement. Again, the cost for those houses would cost more to construct because of the raised elevation for each one of the slabs. So there would be dirt bought in from somewhere.
Right, and it makes better sense to do a basement.
The alternative is to build a basement and use that dirt to elevate the next lot.
Right. And the basements do create a better elevation situation on exactly those lots than what you would otherwise have.
And I think that that's a responsible fix. It just, the frustration, I think, is maybe it's not being apparent, is that exists.
I mean,
you know, we're not responsible for the engineer doing the right thing. And I think that, though, as I said before, if people are expecting that we have workforce housing, that I think that there's a public perception that means something. Hey, I'm workforce. I can afford that. Well, maybe not. And it just that's just the frustration. I'm sure we're doing the right thing by putting the basements in and remedying, you know, taking a bad situation and doing the best with it. So
what's the total funding that we're getting from EPA and from North Central Regional Planning?
We have received from EPA today $243,000. That was matched by $198,819 of funds that Mr. Welsh put into the project. Okay. We're receiving from North Central Regional Planning Commission $130,000. We've turned down the fact that $118,750 from HUD because of the street elevations were 1 foot above. Actually, the whole subdivision would have had to been brought in dirt filled to 1 foot above the base flood elevation.
I think we're going to be really happy with that.
So housing
development.
245 and 130 is what we're at?
Yes.
Okay, so you divide that by the 27 lots. That means each lot received a subsidy of about $13,888.
Sure.
So not only are these houses a slab home that are starting at basically with specials probably $150,000 to $160,000, they should have been $14,000 cheaper because of the subsidy.
We were working off the base cost of the house. We did not put any special assessments into the original cost of the $135,000 or $140,000. Special assessments were never included in that original base cost of the house. That was the house itself under the guidelines that we put together for the energy efficiency, better cabinets, those type of things that went into the house.
Mm-hmm. I'm just saying that $14,000 applies to each one of those houses.
Sure.
So if you actually look at this slab home, that's how many square feet?
1300 square foot
house. We'll go on the high side. It's 140,000 for specials, but it really, because of the subsidy, is 155,000, and then your specials are actually above that. So the more we add the real numbers in here, we're looking at a house that's 1300 square foot, that's a slab, that really has a value after specials. The cheapest one, if we even go with your $9,000 amount, about $164,000, with the basement version at $185,000.
Okay.
So the slab's $164,000, 1,200, 1,300 square foot with a basement's $185,000. That is not affordable or workforce housing to me. And I agree with Commissioner Blanchard. Probably going with these basements is the end of this, we fix it. If you remember when I sit in your office, I said, just because the money's there doesn't mean we need to take it.
That's exactly right. We did not with HUD.
And I feel like this got way too expensive for what's affordable. And I would encourage the chamber to try and come up with a number that's a little bit more believable for workforce housing, or perhaps redevelopment of housing or something, rehabbing housing or something else, because I don't think most taxpayers or most homeowners or anybody, I think I'm probably the only person up on this panel who lives in a house that's more expensive than those or even close. So you have 4 out of 5 commissioners who don't even live in a house that expensive, and it's workforce housing.
Madam Mayor, I want to call the question.
We haven't had the motion yet.
You can.
I move we approve resolution number 137049, authorizing First Amendment to Workforce Housing Development Agreement with Todd Welsh relating to the proposed construction of basements in 7 of the 27 workforce housing units to be constructed in the Pheasant Ridge Subdivision Number 2.
I think we may want to make sure the public is done talking.
Is there a second? Or?
I believe
this second, and then you can talk all you want.
I believe the public was done.
Okay. Was there a second? I mean, I don't want to speak out of order.
Second.
Okay. First of all,
all those in favor? There was a motion and a second.
I think the chair is out of order.
I think we can.
Are we going to keep discussing?
I think we can regroup pretty quickly here, if we may. You do have a motion and a second, as I would understand.
Correct.
Commissioner Hardy called the question. That technically requires a two-thirds vote to call the question. Does the fact that a motion was now made satisfy your concern, Commissioner?
Yes.
And I do think if it works for everyone, we would just regard the motion as standing. That would certainly allow, if anyone does wish to make further comment, and Mayor, if you would like to invite the public to speak, that's still
an option
available to you. And I did have one quick point to make as well, if I may, so, but I don't expect to necessarily be first.
No, by all means.
No, I just wanted to make sure that And I needed to look to Mr. Hobby. I reviewed the proposed agreement, but I know that Aaron Martin in our office had worked primarily with Mr. Hobby, and I didn't know if the commission would be inclined to approve the agreement. The recitals should certainly reflect the basis upon which that is being entered into, and we can certainly modify the recitals appropriately, as you might wish.
Mr. Bankston, is the motion to call the question, that's not debatable? Do we need to vote on that?
I understood that Commissioner Hardy was fine that we were progressing appropriately, and it would ordinarily require a second and a two-thirds vote.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Well, then are we left to assume that the debate is still open then, or?
The discussion is.
Yeah. That was my understanding, that we now have a motion and that
discussion follows the motion.
Not to supersede the mayor's discretion, but I would think that it would be appropriate now that a motion is on the floor to allow the public and the commissioners to address that motion.
So there was a motion. Can I get the clerk to review the motion and the second?
Or the motion on the table?
Are you talking about just who made it?
Who made it and what the motion was?
He didn't hear it.
It was moved by Commissioner Crawford, second by Mayor Shirley, to adopt resolution number 137049, authorizing the mayor to execute a First Amendment to the Workforce Housing Development Agreement to Todd Welsh, Inc., setting forth the terms and conditions relating to the developer's proposed construction of basements in 7 of the 27 workforce housing units to be constructed in the Pheasant Ridge subdivision number 2.
And that was seconded by the mayor? Okay. I'd like to then, if Commissioner Crawford doesn't have a comment to make, I'll proceed.
I have a comment I'd like to make too. This is not an optimal decision. This is not an optimal situation. It's not working according to plan, but not everything we are going to be asked to decide is optimal or something that we feel really good about. I think this solution is a workable solution. Whether it falls within our guidelines of what we consider to be workforce housing, personally, I think it stretches it a little bit. But we have a situation here that we need to deal with, and I think that the best way to deal with it is to, say that, sure, mistakes were made, and move on.
I agree. And I would just like to say, though, I would like to have the contract, though, reflect the intent of changing the contract due to the engineering versus, if that's possible, versus stating. And so if it needs to be amended or strike D and or amended, I don't know, but I think it would more accurately reflect kind of what the reason for the amendment.
Certainly. May I ask Commissioner Blanchard that if that would seem to be a logical proposed amendment to the main motion, if you wouldn't mind articulating what you would like the recitals to reflect. I don't mean word for word, but just in general. And if that prevails, we can certainly modify the recitals accordingly.
Okay, and I will leave it to council to put it in the proper terms of the spirit of what I intend to is to strike D.
Right.
The amendment would be I move to amend to strike in the recitals D, strike the words strike the words marketability and diversity of the overall development. I would just say to
compensate for
maintain the affordability of the housing units. I just have a problem with the marketability and diversity. So
I have a problem with the affordability. But I think you stated it maybe best, unfortunately. So do we need to have a second on his amendment to the motion?
When he's finished, yes.
Oh, is that it?
I gathered maybe you weren't finished. I didn't mean to presume that.
No, I'm sorry. Yeah, I was just kind of trying to make this motion and not be too critical of the engineering, but it is a bit frustrating.
I'm just brutally honest.
Yeah. To maintain the viability of the overall development while maintaining, or to strike, to increase the marketability and diversity of the overall development and replace that, to correct engineering and maintain the affordability from that point forward.
I really like viability.
I wondered.
Amend the amendment.
I think we'll just. I don't think we'll go there. Okay, yeah. That cap it. I'll second that.
All right. Then you have a motion and a second, Mayor, on the amendment. So it's just a question of that, whether that prevails or not. And once we know the answer to that, then we can go back to the main motion and for consideration.
Okay. So I have a first and a second to the amendment to do some rewording and strike words from item D. All those in favor?
Aye.
All those opposed? That amendment passes. And then can I do my...
Right, you're back to your main motion, so...
Back to my main motion.
Right.
Which I had a... Commissioner Crawford moved and I seconded resolution number 13-7049 as amended by Commissioner Blanchard. All those in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? Motion passes 5-0. Any other public comments or other business?
Madam Mayor, just 15 seconds. I was going through a state document and I noticed that our own Luann Elsie had just crossed the 15-year anniversary date with the city. And I just wanted to
look at that.
Did you start when you were 12?
Fantastic.
No way, 15 years? Goodness.
Did she get like a gold pin or anything? Or?
Extra day off?
Yeah. Yeah, good luck.
Well, in honor
of
Luann.
That's fantastic.
Madam Mayor, I move to recess into executive session for 30 minutes to discuss with legal counsel matters subject to the attorney-client privilege for the reason that public discussion of those matters would waive the privilege and adversely affect the city's interest in the matters, and reconvene at 7:40.
Second.
I have a motion and a second to go into executive session. All those in favor?
Aye. Aye.
We are in executive session.
All right.
Yeah. Commissioners, we just for sake of the folks at home and the folks here, we do not expect to have you come out and take any action.